3, and then it's 2:47, and you can't be like, hey, I got to go. It's a hard thing to tell the bosses that.
Yeah.
But that was reality. Well, now, all I got to do is run up the stairs, man.
Yeah.
I
mean, sorry for the convenience.
Yeah. I mean, that's why I've been on time. It's not like I've made this big change in my life.
Yeah. Well, here's what bothers me, though, because, okay, so you texted me earlier this afternoon, literally probably like 30 minutes ago, and you said, can you go to Smoothie King to get you a smoothie? And I said, that's fine, but I'm probably going to be late if I do that, which is not a big deal. But then you said, no, it's all good. I'll go to Sonic. Like, number one, it's not a big deal at all for me to go to Smoothie King, pick you something up. Not a big deal at all. But number two, I don't want you to feel like you have to rush over here, you know, disobey the traffic laws just so you're here on time. I can take it over for a couple minutes, man. We're not going to go too far off the beaten path, hopefully.
If we were in a situation where you stopped to get Brent food and Brent wasn't here on time and I had to bring in the show, lowest ratings there would ever be.
I almost want to like just try to set it up a little bit and make that happen just so I can hear what Kuz got to say.
Well, we've run into some issues. This is Kuz. I don't know what's going on because I don't normally look at the text before the show starts.
Join the club.
I just got done playing video games.
Yeah.
I'm working on my WAPE show at 95.1. I've got some stupid topic that we're going to debate tonight.
I got an interview with Breland later if you guys want to hop over.
Oh, that's today, right?
That's today. Stick around. I got to leave at 4, by the way.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, there you go. Go and leave again. Yep. Especially during these times.
But, it is fun. But here's the thing. Well, first of all, I thought of social distancing. I probably shouldn't be asking you to get me anything food-wise. FC would be responsible.
Yeah.
But secondly, this is how I think. First of all, I miss that rush. Like, I like rushing around sometimes. I've said this before.
How is that enjoyable?
Oh, I love it. Like, the worst shows I have on TV are the ones that are done like an hour and a half in advance. So I purposely will leave stuff till the last 5 or 10 minutes that I have to fix or finish because I want that rush. Well, like, I need that rush. Okay. Like, I want it.
Okay.
And so I
a little bit of a sociopath, but go on.
A little bit.
Yeah, a little bit.
Thrill seeker.
I don't mind the pressure of that. Like, I think that, like, I'm on my A game more so, like, on TV if I have to finish something quick. Like, that's why I love Friday nights in TV.
Okay.
Because you're running on the set. Mm-hmm. Like, I love that. Like, I am in the minority on that, but I love that.
Yeah.
And I find myself in my career, like, I feel like I have had worse shows and made more mistakes on shows, sloppy mistakes, when I have a show done like an hour in advance. So, we used to have a saying in Albany when I worked with those guys, it was like, the show is never done, right? And so, well, I try to make sure it's not done now until like a minute before I'm about to go on. So I didn't mind rushing in. Now, try not to break laws, but this is how my world thinks. So I tell you, I'm like, hey, I'm already pulling into Sonic. I could be a good quarterback. I've made an audible.
Literally in like 2 minutes, like, can I get a chance to respond quick?
Well, then I changed. I was like, I actually said, you know what? I think I have extra time. Like, I'm faster than I thought. I'm going to the Great American Sandwich Shop. On the beach.
Yep.
Have you ever been there?
No.
It's good.
The fries are good.
Now, it's not on my real diet stuff, so I haven't been very often, but I'm like, hey,
times
man.
Times are tough right now, bro.
Times are difficult.
Yeah.
You know? Come on. I'm gonna break the diet
Treat
for
Treat yourself.
Minute.
Yeah.
So
what'd you get?
It's a steak sandwich with some fries.
Okay.
So not ideal, but...
Yeah.
So that's kind of... So I said, I'm gonna even take it to the... So I really probably could have been here about 4 minutes ago if I just stuck to the Sonic plan.
You're all good. I'm going to be honest with what's going on in my life right now. I'm not sure if you watched the governor of Florida kind of do his press conference. But,
I didn't,
you know,
but I heard something about it.
But we did, and obviously, you know, they're shutting down pretty much everything now, right?
Yes, Friday morning, I think.
Yep, only like an essential thing. So right when he said that, I'm like, well, we had a good run. Now it's back to Skype, you know, at home and everything like that, and hopefully it's going to be okay. But keep in mind, I'm fresh in the media scene, right? So I don't really consider what we do essential. But...
Mm-hmm.
Thankfully, the governor does, and I'm not even joking here. Right when he said that, he said like the radio, you know, and obviously the hospitals and everything, grocery stores, all the essential things. And all of a sudden at the end, he's like, radio. I'm like, and I kind of perked up a little bit because
did he actually say it?
I think he said it was like
TV and radio media.
Yeah, the media. And for the first time, man, like I left that press conference watching it, thinking I'm gonna be Batman now because. As a kid, Brent, like, I grew up wanting to be an astronaut, you know, I grew up wanting to be a firefighter, but I kind of went through a Batman phase like a lot of kids do, but this is the closest that I'm ever going to be to being Batman now, because And this is how I'm going to visualize it. Every single day, I'm going to walk out of my apartment, okay? And my wife's going to be there. My son's going to be there. And my son's going to come up running to me because he always gets a hug before I leave. He's going to be like, Daddy, do you really have to go? Do you really have to go? And I'm going to turn around. I'm going to be wearing shades, too. I'm going to turn around and say, well, son, someone's got to talk about the Jacksonville Jaguars. And then, boom, music and everything and just smoke and just, like, badass stuff. And then another time I'm going to visualize it where my son and I were watching ESPN, you know, and all of a sudden, breaking news, Yannick Ngakoue, tweet, you know, post something about the Jaguars in a negative light. And my son's going to look at me. He's like, do you really have to go? I'm like, someone's got to talk about Yannick Ngakoue tweeting, son. I got to get out of here. And then my wife's going to be in the background saying, you were right 3 weeks ago. I can't believe you called it. I'm like, I know. And then I'm going to go to the studio here because I'm essentially Batman now.
I
so,
like it.
You know what? It feels good to be essential,
yeah,
man.
I thought about this in the last couple of weeks, like essential versus non-essential.
Yeah.
Like how many people now have a complex about being essential or non-essential?
Dude, it's going to get to my head so much.
Yeah.
I'm going to be calling 911. When I drive to work every single day, and if I see somebody running on the sidewalk, you're getting a phone call. I'm calling 911.
Non-essential.
I saw that debate, actually. People were tweeting about it. Like, if your friends, right, were like, hey, party tonight, my place, come on over, would you rat them out?
No.
How about for $5,000?
My friends probably. Oh,
$5,000?
That was the follow-up. Would you do it? No. Would you do it for $5,000?
Yes. Yeah.
I'm not going to rat out my friends, Brent.
I'd rat your ass out. I'd do it for $5,000.
As Brent Marno told me the first day on the job, trust nobody. I'm like, well, are we going to be friends or not? How does
Austin
that work?
Austin sends you a text. Hey, man, having some people over my place if you want to come. Brent responds, sure, the cops will be there in five.
Yeah.
$5,000.
But no,
I can't wait,
man. It starts Friday, right? It starts tomorrow or Friday?
Yeah, I think 6 a.m. Friday.
Friday, I'm going to be pulling up here, and if heaven forbid I see somebody jogging with their family on the sidewalk, I'm literally going to stop my car and be like, get off this sidewalk, you crazies. And they're going to be like, where are you going? And I'm going to show my Cox Media badge. Someone's got to report on the Jaguars, and
effective,
I'm out of here.
Effective April 3rd.
6 a.m.
Snitching on everybody.
1 a.m., so Friday.
I found that part of this very interesting. Like, Disney, if you go way back, remember they had that picture on that Sunday? It was like the last day Disney was ever going to be open again.
Yeah.
So everybody went. I mean, they always go, it's crowded. But they announced like on Thursday of that week that Disney will close on Sunday. They gave them a 3-day heads up.
Yeah.
You know, the beaches, some of them, when they closed, it was like a day and a half or 2 days later, like Clearwater or wherever. It's an interesting deal. Now, I guess you kind of should give people a heads up. Maybe you give them a little bit of time to get their stuff in order, especially something like this. This isn't like an entertainment venue. You're talking about work and
especially
how do you get all that stuff?
All the businesses, man, that are going to be shut down, you got to keep in mind.
So I get it, but it is interesting to me that here we are. You have 48 hours or something to kind of get it all together.
Yeah.
It's important to do it, but not important until Friday.
Yeah.
It's just kind of, there's something ironic about that. But that is the case. That's the latest news. But ESPN has changed, at least ESPN 690 has changed the E of entertainment to essential.
Yes. I like that.
And the ESPN.
I like that. Essentials. I love it. I don't know what ESPN stands for. I mean, essential sports. I don't know. I don't even know what we stand for, man. What does ESPN stand for?
Okay, ESPN, you gotta go back. Entertainment and Sports Programming Network.
Did you know what it said?
Yeah, I did. You got me stuck on the essential.
Okay.
So we could just take out the and part. So it could just be Essential Sports Programming Network.
Absolutely.
Yep, I like it.
Forget about the entertainment.
I like it.
It's essential.
Yep.
I'm going to actually get a new T-shirt that just has an E in a circle.
just so you're going to join Mike in my superhero fantasy here? Welcome, man.
That's what he's going to go by. He's
come on in. We got plenty of room in the pool right now. Come on in.
Your superhero name's going to be Essential Man.
Essential Man. See, I can't wait, man.
The fun thing about Austin is I've learned a little bit about him more and more. Well, one of the things you were working on recently, I saw on your computer, when we were testing, in case we weren't essential, by the way,
yeah,
is that you were kind of making like your own little, you were using green screens and stuff.
Yeah,
so you like
yeah.
to, you like to delve into that.
I do, man.
You can make your own little comic here.
I can, man.
Little superhero thing.
We can definitely set it up. We can definitely set it up.
I mean, you got this.
Dude, hey, go like, I mean, who's like a big producer? Like, Michael Bay from like Transformers and everything. Like, hey, go ahead and take a seat because I got it from here. Okay, I'm gonna make these like little segments of my son obviously crying. Come back. I'm like, nope, can't do it. Got to go talk about sports. And then you know my wife's gonna be like wrapped. Like, you know how every single astronaut movie is where they go to space and right before they say goodbye, the wife's holding like the kid around the neck a little bit, and she's kissing him on the head. Like,
oh yeah.
Oh, don't worry, he's coming back. That's what's gonna happen in my place.
That,
I can't
until
wait.
Like in an hour, Mayor Lenny Curry calls us and says, you guys now just turn yourself into non essential.
After talking about this for this long, you are no longer essential.
Yep. Keep it up, boys.
The other thing our coworkers were talking about doing was potentially doing like reenacting movie scenes, like joking, like I would be one, but everyone's in different spots, so you have to film it differently. So we should do like sports movies, like do a scene from The Sandlot between the three of us, but we have to film them at home, and so we'll like get the script and just like act it out and stitch it together.
I would probably not be good at that, but I like the idea.
I'd be horrible too. Yeah.
By the way, I just instead we play marshmallow baseball at home. Is that close enough?
I saw that. Yeah. You guys are killing it over there.
Marshmallow baseball. Man, I tell you, we laughed so much last night. Like, find whatever you want to do.
Yeah.
But marshmallow baseball is a thing. We did it in Panama City back when the kids. It was a rainy day. It was like a stormy, and we had this hotel room or condo or whatever, and Ty was playing in a tournament in there, so they were like six.
Okay.
And that's where it was born. I don't even know how it was born, but we got these big marshmallows.
Yeah.
And we're playing it like in a hotel room, and it was awesome until Steph like lost an eye. But like she actually got drilled in the eye. But so we used to play with our hand. Well, now we play with one of those little souvenir bats.
Yeah.
Well,
the velocity can be that much faster.
Well, it can be faster, but you better have good hand eye. Like, I swung and missed, like, a lot. I was the worst one of the bunch.
Interesting.
I mean, it's hard to hit it, and the bat's so small. It's like 18 inches. That's it.
Yeah.
And I'm also afraid you get slippery, and I'm going to either put it right through our TV or I'm going to let it fly, and it's going to hit somebody, and we're going to the hospital. So it's not the most safe game.
What if you did like a tennis version, like be on your knees with a tennis, like a smaller tennis racket? And
you could do it that way. Actually go with smaller marshmallows. You mean with the actual tennis?
With the marshmallow,
you can't bounce
off.
Nah, you can't do it with marshmallows.
See, I told
you, find a way.
We grew up playing floor hockey at hockey tournaments in the hotel when we would stay. We played floor hockey. You know, you get like the little hockey sticks, get a big tape roll and a little floor hockey in the hotel hallways. Until you got called on because you're too loud.
Yeah, I mean, that's
all the
true.
Time.
That would happen all the time.
It's very loud,
It's fun, though. I mean, I'm not saying it's the safest one to do, so be careful. People did say, like, roll up
Make sure you put that disclaimer out there for everybody.
That's a major disclaimer.
Not trying to get sued on the show.
I actually, Steph started to hit, and so she's lighting me up a little bit as I'm pitching. And Steph never really played, and so she's like, throw it faster or something like that. So she said, throw it faster. So I threw it like as hard as I could, and I threw it over
the plate. Crown the plate a little bit.
Now I'm trying to hit like the blinds. Like I'm throwing it up. Well, I throw it so low, like it came so close to hitting her in the face.
Crown
like,
the plate. Bring it off the plate.
Get it off the plate. It hit her ponytail. Like I was like, I'm still cringing today. Like she doesn't know how close that came to like really buzzing her in the face. And it would have hurt, man.
Are we this close talking about the first ever marshmallow baseball brawl? Like, I mean, you know the Houston Astros are going to get a little physical, man? Man.
I will say this, though. We laugh. We had so much fun playing.
Well, let me ask you this question.
I didn't know you could have that much fun with your family.
Where did the idea for marshmallow baseball, because you never told the story where it came from.
Well, like I said, Panama City Beach, like years ago, and we've played it one other time since, and this was like the third time we've played it. Well, the other time, maybe in like a hurricane or something. But, I don't know who started. I don't know who gave us the idea.
Okay.
I really don't. It was probably someone on Ty's baseball team. I don't remember that. I don't think we were the brainchild for it. Mm-hmm. But we even put seams on the marshmallow yesterday.
I know, I saw that. Yeah.
And it's a lot. I mean, we might play a 162-game season. That was game one. Might have to bring out the national anthem and everything starting tonight.
I like it.
Game two. Although today, there's not a scheduled game today because we gave a day in case of rain.
I like your style.
You know, early in the season, you got to be – really, it's more about recovery.
Well, man, if you need some audience, just invite me over. I'll come drink some beer and have a hot dog. And I'll start cheering you guys on.
Live stream it.
Well, I've actually thought about so far lives. I don't know. Steph won't allow me to live stream it.
Okay.
Like she really doesn't want me to do that. But I've thought about it now. And I also thought about live streaming Ty and I in a ping pong match on Twitter.
I'm surprised you guys haven't started doing golf trick shots.
Yeah, I'm not a trick shot golf guy.
Okay, because there's a lot of those going on.
I know. There are good ones. Like, I saw Billy Horschel's. That was really good.
They're all good, yeah.
Yeah, and I would. It would take me until the end of coronavirus to do what Billy Horschel did.
Those videos, I guarantee you, there were hours of tries before that actually happened.
Well, yeah, well, maybe that's not with Horschel. Latter one I saw with Horschel made sense.
That's why I've never been a fan of, like, those Dude Perfect guys. Like, I get it, man. Props to you for making your money and everything. But, like, some of those shots when they were first starting out, it had to take them probably a week to accomplish one such shot. I'm like, I'm not that impressed. Sorry.
We went 20 minutes without talking, Jay. This wasn't intended, but I liked the conversation.
Nah, man.
It was a lot of fun.
It's
We're just
random.
Trying to give you something to do. Have fun with the family. Be safe, though.
Yeah.
Watch out for flying marshmallows.
Yes, absolutely.
It really can happen. When we come back, we will talk Jags. Doug Marrone talked about a lot of topics yesterday and a lot that we didn't get to on yesterday's show. Later on in the show, you haven't seen it, but I watched this Christian Dawkins documentary. This was about the FBI and the feds and when they were investigating the NCAA. Fascinating. How did I, at the end of that, somewhat feel bad for Dawkins, who was right in the middle of this thing? Odd. I don't know if you've seen it yet, but it's out there to see. Maybe something else to watch other than Tiger King if you've now seen that three different times.
Have you seen it yet?
No.
All right.
Still no go.
Still rolling strong, my man.
Yeah. Marshmallow Baseball took the cake.
I like it.
Instead of Tiger King.
Good.
When we come back, we talk some football for real, the Jaguars. What's the latest on them? What does Doug Marrone have to say about some of their position groups? Talk about it on ESPN 690.
Action Sports Jax with Brent Martineau on ESPN 690 is brought to you by Best Bet Jacksonville and Orange Park.
Now, the first alert forecast on ESPN 690.
Partly to mostly sunny, breezy, and cooler today. High 70 to 75, and quite cool tonight all the way down into the 40s. Join me beginning at 5 p.m. for CBS 47 and Fox 30 Action News Jax from the First Alert Weather Center. I'm Chief Meteorologist Mike Burrish.
This is a CMG Open for Business report. During these changing times, it's challenging for businesses across North Florida, big and small. But businesses are adjusting to meet your needs in a safe and comfortable way. Here's today's list of businesses that are open for you. Green Cove Auto Sales, Kent's Mobile RV Generator Service, Frontline Fencing, Pascal Brothers Hardware, UPS Store, Jack Stage and Lighting. If you're open for business, let us know by emailing us at openjacks, J-A-X, at cmg.com. Together, we're getting through this.
Hey, boss, check out this headline. Safe Touch Security. Your health and safety are all we do.
Safe Touch again? Is that all you ever talk about?
Boss, your mom still has a Safe Touch security system, right?
That is correct. Don't make any comments.
No, I can't blame you. Having a Safe Touch system is like having a halo of protection surrounding her.
Exactly. For instance, let's say, God forbid, that she needed the fire department.
Not to worry, Safe Touch can respond.
Or let's say she stubbed a toe, the mother of all toe stubs, and she couldn't get to the phone.
Safe Touch can contact emergency toe fixes.
I never thought I'd say this, but I'm glad Safe Touch is out there.
Boss!
I know, but that doesn't mean we don't stick to the Crux of Us motto. Stay away from Safe Touch houses.
Crooks know to stay away from Safe Touch houses. Hi, I'm Lester Jackson, president of Safe Touch Security Systems. No one beats our technology or our price.
Call Safe Touch today at 888-723-8682 or go to safetouch.com. State license number EF233.
CGC Water Treatment is celebrating Kinetico's 50th year anniversary with 50% savings for you. Purchase a Premier softener and save 50% off a K5, Kinetico's Premier reverse osmosis system. When the shelves at the store are empty, it's a great feeling to have purified water right at home. Call 904-694-2242. Financing available with approved credit. Don't worry about needing bottled water. Call 904-694-2242 or visit cgcwater.com. Tell them Brent sent you. CGC Water Treatment, your local independent Kinetico dealer.
After a long day, having my dogs meet me at the door with their silly smiles and wagging tails makes me happy. I want to keep that joy with me for years to come. That's why I trust Forever Vets Animal Hospital to keep my pets healthy. Forever Vets was voted 2019's Best Vet in Jacksonville Magazine's Readers' Poll, and it's easy to see why. The affordable wellness plans are tailored to meet all of your pets' changing needs as they grow. Open 7 days a week, Forever Vets' friendly staff is available to treat you and your pet with care. They combine extended hours with online booking to allow you to give your pet quality care while accommodating your schedule. Go online to forevervets.com to find which of their 8 offices is nearest you. And don't forget the newest location in Riverside, Forever Vets Animal Hospital, keeping your pets happy and healthy forever.
J. David Tax Law wants you to know that they are here to help individuals and businesses with tax debt issues during the coronavirus pandemic. Hey, everybody, this is Brent Martineau. Tax problems can be extremely stressful, especially now. If you owe a tax debt, there are new programs available that can help reduce or eliminate your IRS or sales tax burden. These programs expire on July 15th, so don't wait. Get the help you need with tax debt, payroll taxes, bank levies, wage garnishments, tax liens, and unfiled returns. With a $1 trillion economic stimulus package on the way, the IRS will be collecting an unprecedented amount of tax debt to fund this historic initiative. At J. David Tax Law, only highly experienced tax attorneys will represent you. Never trust your tax situation to anyone you can't walk in and look in the eye. If you have federal or state sales tax debt, have a sit down with J. David Tax Law. Your first step is a no-cost consultation. Call J. David Tax Law at 904-507-4777 or go to jdavidtaxlaw.com.
This is a CMG Open for Business report. During these changing times, it's challenging for businesses across North Florida, big and small, but businesses are adjusting to meet your needs in a safe and comfortable way. Here's today's list of businesses that are open for you. Lowe's, ERA Davis Lynn Realty, Glass Specialist, Ortho Edge Telehealth, Benton Integrity Roofing, SunState Window Tinting. If you're open for business, let us know by emailing us at openjax@cmg.com. Together, we're getting through this.
Hey, it's Coos from Action Sports Jax on ESPN 690. Now, I know there's a ton of ways you can listen to the show, but did you know one of the ways is through a smart speaker? Yes, the Google Home, the Amazon Alexa. It's pretty easy to do. Just tell either of them to play ESPN 690. Try it out weekdays from 3 to 6 p.m., and you can listen to Action Sports Jax.
Brent Martineau.
You see him every day on CBS 47, Fox 30, Action Sports Jax.
Austin Lane.
He's a former Jag star and current MMA fighter.
Broadcasting live from the Anajar and Levine studio.
This is Action Sports Jax on ESPN 690 and ESPN690.com.
I think everyone in the building, you know, has a good understanding of, you know, that we want them to feel like it's their team. You know, we want them to feel like they're a part of it, you know, just like I am, just like our fans, everyone. You know, we want everyone to really feel that. So I think, you know, when you don't make a lot of changes, like we talked about, but if we can all change individually and you know, giving us, you know, a little bit more or 10% or a brighter look on the future or whatever we have to do, I think that's how a culture can change.
That was taken directly from Rocky IV, by the way.
Was it?
If I can change and you can change, then we can all change.
So here's the deal. I asked Doug Marone a little bit about the culture because I really think he wants to do that. Mm-hmm. He wants to. He knows it, okay? And I'm not speaking. I'm not putting words in his mouth. This is my view. You could not have. See, someday there will be a great. If Doug Marone wants to write a book about this chapter of his career, or if he really wants to open up and talk about last season, we saw it in training camp, man. But this, so that means it started way back in probably March or maybe even back in January. But what we saw was this distancing from Doug Marone and Tom Coughlin. We saw the Tom Coughlin way of things, his mentality, which, by the way, I don't believe, and I think we're in the same boat here, we don't believe it's really that different. If you look at the careers of both men, we think Coughlin and Marone are kind of similar guys in terms of how they approach it. They want to play tough football, physical football. They want to run hard camps. They mm-hmm. want to get the most out of you that way. I don't think Marone, from my opinion, was never really in that player coach kind of jovial category. So. And that doesn't mean players don't like that's different. But I didn't see him in that light. Same with Coughlin. You know, you never put Belichick in that. You put Belichick and Coughlin and Marone kind of fit in the same column, okay? I guess that's the easiest way to say it. Hmm. Whether they are exactly the same or not, that's debatable, but they're in the same column, in my opinion. Well, last year we saw this huge separation. I mean, we saw this separation in camp. There's no way Tom Coughlin would sign up for the camp that they had last year. He wouldn't. Mm-hmm. Whether he's too stubborn, whether he's right, whether it just isn't the way, he would never do it. Doug Marrone did it. He did it differently. He went 180 from what they had done the first 2 years. Every camp is hard, but this one was definitely more player-friendly, undoubtedly. And even the preseason games. Not Tom Coughlin. If Tom Coughlin in 17 and Marrone, by the way, as well, they said, you guys are playing. In fact, I remember in 17, I know we weren't doing the show together, but I remember in 17, there was like, why are they still in? Mm-hmm. It was that kind of conversation in the preseason. Well, then you take to the Jalen Ramsey stuff and everything that ended up happening. It was so different from Tom Coughlin. It was a detachment. Again, you can debate, and history will say whatever it was, is it right or wrong? It just was. Mm-hmm. And so that was my perception of it. Doug Marrone hasn't come out and said that, but I think that was clear as day from the outside looking in. And at the end of the year, when they were announced back, did a show from the parking lot, December 31st, last day of 2019, and Dave Caldwell and Doug Marrone. And you could tell they were trying to change it. They were trying to shift it. And one of the big shifts was communication throughout the building. Doug Marrone wanted to invite everybody into the conversation in the building. In that building, there's not a lot of windows. There's a ton of walls. Mm-hmm. It's an old building. It's not like this new, like, hey, everybody can see each other in this open space and all that stuff. It's not.
It's not like when you walk in, there's like cheers or anything.
No, man. It's not like the open floor plan you would see in a house. Yeah, it's very segmented and walls are up.
Yeah.
Well, he wanted to break down some of those walls. I think that's fair to say. And part of that is communication with the ticket office, with the sales folks, with the people that make the meals every day, with the training staff, with everybody. Not just, hey, we're football people and we go to meetings and we're better than you, you know, that sense. Mm-hmm. No, he wants everybody to be a part of it and feel a part of it. And again, I am not saying Marrone might say it differently. I'm trying not to put words in his mouth. This is my perception of what he was trying to do and build. And I think he did say a lot like this, like, hey, I want to communicate. I want to keep everybody in it. And so what I asked him when he met with the media yesterday, and I did a little bit extra with him a couple questions later after about a story that I'm working on. And one of my questions was about the culture. Are you having a hard time building that culture because you can't be in the building to open it up to everybody? Mm-hmm. Now, if you look at Jaguars.com and what they've done, the series called The Hunt, which has been very good, well done by the boys over there and ladies over there. And go check it out, Jaguars.com. But you'll see the difference in transparency. And so part of this new culture, this new Jags, after Tom Coughlin and Doug Marrone and Dave Caldwell, is being transparent, opening it up, being more communicative, I think is a word, with everybody.
Yeah.
Even the fans.
Yeah.
But definitely the people inside. And so I think that's hard to do right now, given this situation. Everybody's on Zoom and everybody's isolated. And so you can't really walk down the hall. So I wonder how that will have a ripple effect on what he's trying to do in terms of build a culture. Now, the one caveat here is the players haven't been there. And so in terms of building the culture, it kind of does start with the players. I know he wanted to communicate with the entire building, but it's really about the players on a lot of levels and what you do on Sundays. So he hasn't had to do that quite yet. So that will be an interesting facet, how he can kind of build this culture that he wants to do, this little pivot in culture that they had over the last few years, and he wants to lead that. But can he do that without OTAs, without off-season conditioning and all those things? I think that's what's kind of fascinating about these last few weeks and maybe the next couple of months ahead for Doug Marrone.
So take the first-year coaches out of it. Take the Matt Rules out of it and everything like that. Take Ron Rivera out of it. It's his first year in Washington. But in terms of who does, you know, with the potential of missing some preseason, with the potential of missing some OTAs, obviously, in the spring, I think that what's going on right now with this COVID-19 is more detrimental to the Jacksonville Jaguars than anybody else. And I say that for a couple reasons. I'm reminded back to 2011 when we're going through a lockout. Okay, now remember what happened back in 2011. The Jacksonville Jaguars select Blaine Gabbert. We still have Dave Girard on the team, and all things considered, he was the quarterback going forward, at least so we thought. Obviously, we can't work out as a team. We do a couple times. I think we went to, is it Episcopal, maybe, the high school? Yep. I think we went to Episcopal. Like, you know, we literally just emailed
Bishop
each other.
Kenny, yeah, Episcopal,
so,
those places.
Bishop Kenny, yeah. I think so. What we did was we emailed each other, and we literally have like three like full team workouts, you know, and it was our first really time we ever met Blaine Gabbert. So we introduced ourselves and everything like that. We run 7-on-7. And like that was great and everything, right? But it wasn't a practice. It wasn't really an OTA. It wasn't a mini camp, but it was the best that we could do. But when we show up for training camp, and keep in mind, we had some pretty solid veterans on that team still. And keep in mind, we're coming from a previous year where I think we went 8-8. You know, we just missed out on the playoffs, yeah. And we really should have went to the playoffs, but we kind of had that three-game skid at the end, and we didn't go. So we had a lot of optimism going into the year. But the terms of lack of communication, the terms of lack of being on the same page, and then sprinkling that on top with Dave Girard getting, I think, you know, let go in the second or third game of the season, and Blaine Gabbert having to go in not expecting to, well, it was just a recipe for disaster. And then you can kind of remember how the 2011 yeah, season went.
Unraveled quickly.
Yeah, it wasn't good. You know, I think Coach Del Rio lost his job halfway through the season, and it was a nightmare. And I think a lot of that stemmed from, you know, the lockout and everything like that.
Yeah, the untold story about that, perhaps. You know, yeah, that's a really good point.
Exactly. So when you analyze the Jacksonville Jaguars right now, what they have, you obviously let Tom Coughlin go. You give, you know, the complete reins now, you would say, to Doug Marrone to try to shape the team in his image. You have Gardner Minshew, who's a second-year guy, still very young, so has to work on some things, that is supposed to be the leader of your team.
And now he's the
right?
guy.
Exactly. You have arguably probably the youngest roster right now in the NFL.
One of.
And you've just let go of two main pillars in A.J. Boye and Calais Campbell. Okay? It's a lot against you right now. And the fact that you can't have everybody under the same roof, you can't work out together. I mean, we'll see. Once again, we don't know how this is going to pan out, yeah. But I think
I think it's safe to say, man, we're not having OTAs in offseason conditions.
Exactly. And the fact that you can't have all the guys under the same roof working out together, you know, bonding with each other, I'm not saying it's essential, but especially a super young team with super young leadership and a coach that's trying to model in his way, there's a lot of things that are stacking against the Jacksonville Jaguars right now.
That's an excellent point, man. Great reference to 2011, because I forget about, you know, to me, 2011 and Jack Del Rio getting fired was a compilation of, hey, he'd been there a long time and all those things. But I forget a lot about that 2011. Yeah. And coming off, oh, wait,
dude,
more optimism in the yeah. building probably than out, because everybody was sour yeah. on the last three games and yeah, not making yeah. the playoffs. But I get it. And add to that Blaine Gabbert, a new franchise quarterback coming in, that always brings optimism. I know it's hard to believe that now, but there does. Well, and that was the yeah. first guy that this franchise had drafted, yeah. like it in forever. Like it had been since 03, I think.
And listen, and I told a story many times. I told a story many times where I was with the ones, so the ones are sitting out during, you know, 7-on-7 and stuff like that, and you know, we're going team on team, obviously not in pads, just walkthrough kind of thing. But I remember sitting with some other defensive guys, you know, like Daryl Smith and Rasheem Mathis, and we're watching Blaine Gabbert throw to the twos. And we all thought, man, this guy's got a cannon. Yeah. Like, this guy's going to be something special. I think we have something here, you know? And, like, there was so much optimism behind that. And it's crazy where you look at it now, obviously, that's gone. Yeah. But anyway,
well, that's what we saw
off.
At practices, yeah. too, man. I mean, exactly. Training camp was like, it's hard. You have to remind people, though, that's what people thought about Gabbert mm-hmm. in practices and also training camp going into that yeah. that immediate year. But I just think your point overall, forget about Gabbert, is excellent in terms of comparing the two. What's kind of ironic is this is a show-me year for Doug Marrone as well. Mm-hmm. I mean, no doubt. You know, much like it was and it turned out to be for Jack Del Rio. Mm-hmm. That's a crazy irony in all of this that almost a decade later, they're dealing with not the CBA, which many people thought they might be dealing with the CBA.
Correct.
But instead, this pandemic that nobody else can control at the moment. And they're going to miss some of that valuable time. I think it's a great point. And they have to navigate that. They have to figure that out. One thing about Doug Marrone, man, he is in touch with, I think, the pulse. Mm-hmm. See, the one, no doubt, Tom Coughlin misread the pulse mm-hmm. of the fans outside the building, the team inside the building didn't see it coming. And it, you know, the way Tom Coughlin has had, in my opinion, a Hall of Fame career, you know, at that stage, 73 years old, you're doing it your way. You've got a couple of Lombardi trophies. It's my way has worked. I mean, I get it. But he didn't see the pulse of the team, and I think even everybody outside. That news conference said it all, right? Yeah. You know, if you go back to that.
Yeah.
But Doug did. See, Doug saw it. Doug saw it last January, coming off 2018. Doug saw it somewhere in March and April. Doug saw it in August. Doug saw it in the fall.
Doug handled himself exactly how I'd handle myself in situations, like looking down for help, like, hey, I want to tell you guys what's going on. It's not my job to do that. Like, I think anybody could relate to that in Doug Marone's position.
And he did a good job. And by, like I said, I think it's an important part of the story is he wasn't always like that, I don't think. I think that was a little bit of a philosophical change for him, too, to go such on the player's side. But he kind of had to do that to separate from Coughlin. And now where does he take this? So I think he'll be able to handle this. It's just how much do the guys absorb it? How much does everybody in the building buy into it? It's a young team. You're going to have 12 draft picks. You've got new players like Schobert and Eifert. You've got new coordinator in Jay Gruden, new QB coach in Ben McAdoo. And that's beyond trying to say, hey, Gardner Minshew, I'm the man now. This is my team. Hey, DJ Chark, let's go do this. Hey, DD Westbrook, let's go do this. Hey, Tyler Eifert, hey, nice to meet you. You know, there's a lot of that stuff that takes place in April and in May that is not. That's going to be up to the players, and I think Minshew will handle that fine. But that'll be up to the players and the coaches to be able to figure that out. And I think it's something that I don't think it's like a sexy thing to talk about. But I do think relate to it, man, because you played in it. And those things that are set up at this time of year, and especially I would say late summer and when you come to camp, usually are pretty vital, you know, for what happens in the fall.
Yeah, absolutely. And I also want to touch on a quick point, too. I think we still have a caller waiting on, so we'll get to that in a second. But, you know, you kind of talked about easing the reins up a little bit like Doug Marone did, right? Like, he had a really easy training camp. And I think the problem with that was, like, listen, I'm all for easing it up a little bit and then letting players get healthy, because I think, like he said, the goal was to have everybody healthy by the time the season started. Mission accomplished. Now, did it turn out to be well for the team? No, obviously they struggled last year. But I'm reminded of a guy like Andy Reid, okay? I think we both agree Andy Reid's a fantastic coach, just won a Super Bowl. The proof is in the pudding. Of all the training camps that I went through, and I went through a couple, Andy Reid's is probably the easiest, okay? But the difference was, and I knew it was easy. You know what I mean? Like, we as a team knew, like, it could be a lot worse.
Yeah.
Right? Like, you know, you hear stories of, you know, like maybe Baltimore, you hear stories of New England, like, dang, man, like they're going like real, real hard. And like, we're just kind of, yeah, it's all right. But the difference is the fact that you have the leaders that, you know, that are appointed by Andy Reid. Like, Andy Reid is he's this good, you know, easygoing guy. He can get after you sometimes if he has to. But that's the captain's job, all right? Like, the captains hold you accountable. It's like there's the chief's way, and either you do it the right way or get out, you know? And that's kind of how it was pretty much like self-monitored, I guess, like self-governed on the Kansas City Chiefs. And I'm sure it's still like that to this day, obviously. And the problem, I think, with the Jacksonville Jaguars, even last year, like, you had some leaders. I mean, you had Calais Campbell, obviously, right? And one could argue you had Jalen Ramsey as well. But how great of leaders were they? I think Calais Campbell was a fantastic leader. I think he was a great job of leading by example.
Yeah,
I think Yannick Ngakoue.
Exactly.
Exactly. But once again, the issue comes this year now, Brent. All right, you've lost Campbell, and you've lost Boye. You've lost Foles.
You lost Foles.
Okay, and I get it. You got Joel Schobert coming in, and you should be excited about that. You have Gunter coming in. You should be excited about that. You do have some key veteran pieces coming in. But the problem is that Joel Schobert just can't come in and lead right away. Okay, that takes time. It takes respect. And the only way to do that is on the football field. So to think that Joe Schobert's just going to come in one day and be like, you know what, I'm the captain now, like, listen to me, it doesn't work like that in the NFL, man. All right, like, you have to earn that respect. And unfortunately, if you're going through the COVID-19 stuff and you miss out on the preseason, you miss out on OTAs, whatever it is, it's hard to get that kind of camaraderie in.
Yeah, and not only that, they're going to have to ask guys to grow up quick. Minshew, obviously, and I'm not saying grow up like an immature, but he just has to do more than a second-year guy quarterback you'd maybe ask him to do. And I think also a guy like Miles Jack needs to really take a step.
Yeah.
You know, he's a guy that has been around. He needs to be a leader, even though he's not the guy in the middle. He needs to be a big-time leader on that defense with Boye and others going away. And don't sleep on a guy like Avery Jones. I think he's an important part of that. They might even ask Josh Allen to do a lot of that.
Jackson, yeah.
And Josh Allen has done it on the field, so now he's got some equity built up in that respect. Let's go to the lines. Action Sports Shacks on ESPN 690. I think Steven's hanging around. Sorry to keep you waiting, man. Hope you're doing well.
It's all right, guys. Great topics you've been talking about. I got one that I would like your opinion on, and it has to deal with the draft and some of the mock drafts I see. In our situation, we probably don't want to end up like Pittsburgh, where Big Ben went down, then Rudolph got his dome smacked, and they had their third string. We can't afford that because we don't have a third string at the moment. A lot of mock drafts I've been seeing, I've seen picks like Jake Fromm from Georgia, Cole McDonald from Hawaii, the guy Tate from Arizona, because I can't pronounce his first name. Could you see some of those guys being a pick worthy for the Jags? Or you could see them as a Jacksonville Jaguar.
Steven, appreciate the call. Thanks, man. Yeah, we talked a little bit quarterbacks yesterday, but that's a good question. Deeper down in the draft, could that happen? Cool. Let's take a timeout, man. On the other side of this, do you want me to take a timeout or go to the top? All right, take a timeout, and we'll talk about that on the other side, because I looked at this the other day, and I think it gets real thin real quick in this draft at quarterback. Mm-hmm. I want to see if you agree with me or not, and to Steven's point, who could they take? Maybe in the middle rounds. Remember, they have 3 4th round picks. Is it even worth going with another young quarterback in that room? Another quarterback with an experience. We'll check in on that when we come back. Action Sports Shacks.
What's
on
Alex
McGuire
do?
He's in Houston still, probably.
Yeah.
They love him.
They should.
Hey, everybody, it's Brent Morneau from Action Sports Shacks. There's a good chance you have a smart speaker, so use it with ESPN 690. Stay up to date on the Jags and all things sports by telling Alexa or Google to play ESPN 690. It's as easy as that. Make sure you listen weekdays 3 until 6 p.m. on ESPN 690.
I'm Glenn Levine, a board-certified civil trial lawyer. That means the Florida Bar has recognized me as an expert in the field of civil trial. As a trial lawyer, I'm trained to investigate every aspect of your case. If you've been involved in a legal dispute and are not sure of your options, call me, Glenn Levine, at the law offices of Anajar and Levine at 904-600-4000. That's 904-600-4000 for a free consultation. And take back control of your life. Office in Jacksonville.
These can be unsettling times, but CGC Water Treatment wants you to know that they are there for you and your family. CGC Water Treatment has 50% savings for you. Purchase a Premier softener and save 50% off a K5, Connecticut's Premier reverse osmosis system. When the shelves at the stores are empty, it's a great feeling to have purified water right at home. Call 904-694-2242 or visit cgcwater.com. CGC Water Treatment, your local independent Connecticut dealer.
Hey, boss, have you heard about Safe Touch? They're now offering a free health and wellness package with every Safe Touch system.
Health and wellness package? Actually, that sounds kind of nice.
Yeah, well, not for us crooks. You know the Safe Touch two-way communicator?
Of course I know the Safe Touch two-way communicator.
Yeah, so we already know that it's the best deterrent against, crooks like us, but it can also be like a 911 dispatcher for other emergencies.
Like medical emergencies.
Yeah, there's the two-way communicator, the emergency buttons, the smartphone app. It's all just extra peace of mind for Safe Touch customers.
Great. As if people need another reason to get Safe Touch.
Well, the good news is it's not going to change our Crooks or Us motto.
Stay away from Safe Touch houses.
Some things never change.
Crooks know to stay away from Safe Touch houses. Hi, I'm Lester Jackson, president of Safe Touch Security Systems. No one beats our technology or our price.
Call Safe Touch today at 888-723-8682 or go to safetouch.com. State license number EF233.
This is a CMG Open for Business report. During these changing times, it's challenging for businesses across North Florida, big and small, but businesses are adjusting to meet your needs in a safe and comfortable way. Here's today's list of businesses that are open for you. Rebound Rehab Physical Therapy, Golden Hammer Roofing, Engel & Volker Realty, Affordable Plumbing, Jack's Craft Beer Draft & Bottle, Nassau Windows & Glass. If you're open for business, let us know by emailing us at openjax@cmg.com. Together, we're getting through this.
Our normal way of life has been changing quickly due to coronavirus. New rules to follow, and basically all sports have been put on hold. Heck, you might even be working from home. Hey, everybody, it's Brent Martineau. If you're not in the car from 3 p.m. until 6 p.m., check in on Action Sports Jacks on your smart speaker. Tell your Amazon Echo or Google Home to play ESPN 690.
This is Action Sports Jax on ESPN 690 and ESPN690.com.
The one thing about the sport is a performance-based business, and really they only care about what you do on Sunday, whether you're the moves you're making or anything like that. You're going to get a bunch of comments. Some are going to be good, some are going to be bad, what they're doing, you know, who they're taking. Well, I don't understand this, I don't understand that. You know, then you go out there on Sunday, and if you play well, you know, hey, obviously these guys know what the hell they're doing. You know, you don't play well, I told you.
It's so true. I like that about Doug Marrone too, man. He knows how it works. He is no dummy when it comes to that, and when it comes to a lot of things. Sorry, I didn't mean say he might be dummy in other things, but he gets it, you know. And it is fun. It's kind of like, what do we always talk? We talk about all these different things with the Jags. Why haven't they been able to figure out? Why haven't they? Why? Well, you know, there's one common answer. There's one easy answer. There's one answer that would make sports radio maybe just go away. If everybody, all 32 teams, had a good quarterback, it wouldn't be fun to talk about.
No, not at all.
Because that's what it is. Every organization, everything starts with that position, and then you can try to find all their problems outside of that position, but it comes back to that position most of the time in some way, shape, or form, especially if they've lost a lot. You know, it usually comes back to that. Well, Doug's right on that front, too. We've heard things about various organizations when it comes to the grievances and all this stuff, but there's a big difference, man. The grievances, the playing for coaches like a Belichick, it doesn't matter if you're getting W's, if you're winning division championships, if you're hosting playoff games, and then eventually if you're winning Super Bowls. If you're winning on Sunday, all that other stuff, I've never seen a sport so much like that. Winning does matter, but I've never seen a sport, and maybe it's just because we cover it up close and really been here for 12 years, and we've mm-hmm. seen the Jags lose so much. See, like, even bad teams in baseball aren't bad for 12 years. Like, yeah. You know, Kansas City Royals for most of my life have been bad, but they won the World Series. Tampa Bay, some people think they're the best team in Major League Baseball
now. The Cubs, man. Look at the Cubs.
The Cubs. The Red Sox have done it. You know, all
and
these
I hate saying the Cubs, but.
But all these teams. And Milwaukee's a good example. They were bad for so long.
Absolutely.
But you're not usually bad for 12 years. Like, mm-hmm. the Browns haven't made the playoffs in 17 seasons. Well, so unlike any other sport, I believe, like in basketball and hockey, and baseball's like this too, you play it again tomorrow. Yeah. It's always like you play again tomorrow. Well, in the NFL, you play again next week, and that feeling stays with you for 6 days. And so much gets hidden, and so different of a feeling when you leave that building on a Sunday at 5 or 6 o'clock, whether you won or lost. And it's unlike anything else because of that, the feeling you get after what it says on the scoreboard, whether it's 1 point or by 20 points.
And I think we had to keep in mind, too, with all professional sports, like with baseball and hockey, like, and basketball as well, like, if you're good this season, more than likely, depending who you lose, but you should be good next season as well, right? Like, I think the window is a lot bigger than it is in football sometimes, right? Like, what happens, Jacksonville Jaguars, AFC Championship, next season, in the tank. Atlanta Falcons should have won a Super Bowl, get beat next year.
Yeah. You know, so good point. And here's a great example of it. Toronto loses Kawhi Leonard, mm-hmm. and they still are good this year.
Forget about it. Kawhi, who? They're all good. They got VanVleet. Yeah.
It's a great example.
Coming? Yeah,
great
exactly. Example. So should we answer Steven's question?
We actually should. You're really worried about Steven. I'm getting too.
No, old. I'm just worried about, like, listen, if we want social interaction, stuff like that, we got to keep in mind that we got to respond.
Okay.
That's
so the question from Steven, we appreciate him hanging on the line for a while before the break, but it was, hey, would you think about Fromm or somebody else? So, we talked about yesterday, Tua Burrow's off the board, but Jordan Love, Justin Herbert, I gave you the reason why I don't think they should even invest in that. And a lot of that has to do with look for next year, and part of looking for next year is finding out if you have the guy in Gardner Minshew. Correct. Don't bring any other competition, because if you don't have the guy, you're probably firing your coaching staff and everybody, so don't pigeonhole that next regime mm-hmm. with a quarterback that they might not want. Let them pick the quarterback in 2021. But it's a fair question once you get into the third round and maybe even the fourth round if some of these guys slip that far. Here's the deal. Here's the top-rated quarterbacks according to CBS. Burrow, Tua, Jordan Love, Justin Herbert, Jacob Eason, Jake Fromm, Jalen Hurts. Then it goes to Anthony Gordon and James Morgan and Brian Lewerke from Michigan State and Jake Luton. I mean, who are these guys? I think it stops with Hurts. And Hurts is a gamble in his own self, in my opinion. But I think there's basically 2, 4, 6, 7 quarterbacks. And Anthony Gordon, I know he's Minshew, Washington State. I get it, but I wouldn't. I wouldn't be picking him.
You got Shea Patterson. You got Francois, even, you know? I mean, there's... So yeah, here,
listen, there's Kelly Bryant. I'm just saying the table really it falls off the table for me after Jalen Hurts.
But you're not essentially getting a backup quarterback. You're getting a third string guy. Okay, so like this is at least it's
but you're not wasting a third round pick on a third string
guy. No, I'm not taking a third round pick. I'm sorry. No,
but that's
I mean,
these guys could. But your point is if you get to the back of the Khalil Tate, that's a sixth round, seventh round pick.
Exactly,
that's fair.
So like. And listen, some teams do it where they only have two quarterbacks, you know, and then they have a practice squad guy. I can see the Jaguars maybe taking like a Francois or somebody late in the draft because obviously you're bringing a guy in for a third round. I'm sorry, for like a third string role, I think at least. You know, I think assuming you don't go after Andy Dalton, like I said, you should a million times, assuming that you have Joshua Dobbs as your backup quarterback. All right, well, I mean, that's serviceable because you got to think that even if Joshua Dobbs comes in, no offense to him, but like if Gardner Minshew's out for whatever reason, your season's probably in the tank, okay? So to me, you don't have to bring in a top, you know, three-round guy and try to groom him. No, man, wait till next year. So, yeah, like a Francois or something like that later in the rounds where you can even practice squad him, right? And then if it comes to an emergency situation, then you sign him, obviously, and things like that. But as far as drafting a guy, especially to me in the first four rounds, I don't think so.
Well, and that answers Steven's question. That Steven wanted to know about those guys, I think, more so. But he did bring up the Khalil Tates and those kind of guys. That would be more – I think there's a big separation. I think you're talking about guys in the – maybe the top three rounds, maybe a little bit into the fourth round when you get to Jalen Hurts and Fromm and Eason. That's as far as they'll go down. I think these other guys – I think there's going to be a gap. There might be a round and a half before you hit another quarterback is my point because there's that much separation. And I think you're right. You have 12 picks. If you're taking a flyer on that guy that you could put on the practice squad and also say, hey, this guy could be around for a little bit. And because I think the mentality in the building is, and I don't know this, I just think it is. This is the way I would be thinking a bit because I kind of feel like, okay, this is how GMs think sometimes. Mm-hmm. We traded a fifth round pick away for Joshua Dobbs. Last year, because of Nick Foles' contract and everything else, and when he came back and we didn't have to use Dobbs, people were like, well, that was a waste of a pick. Mm-hmm. Well, that don't look like a waste of a pick right now. Now you have your backup quarterback, at least for the time being. You know, who knows what happens with Andy Dalton or somebody like that. But for the time being, that fifth-round pick doesn't look wasted because he's on this roster and he's part of your team, and he might be a key part of your quarterback room. I think if you get by through this year and you still have utilized that fifth-round pick with a backup quarterback, well, now you can justify to yourself, okay, that wasn't as bad as it wasn't a wasted pick. Mm-hmm. We had him here just in case. That's what you do. Whether you're spending $4 million or not and the guy never plays, you need an insurance policy at quarterback, and that's what he was, and it was a fifth-round pick. So you can justify it more. I think the way you're saying, if you pick going up in the sixth round or seventh round, he's your third quarterback, you're saying, hey, sit on the practice squad for a year, and then maybe you are a part of our quarterback room a little bit more so in the future because now we can let Dobbs go next year if we don't think we need him anymore. This guy's performing well. Maybe we found a little something a la a Minshew. Mm-hmm. I think those things make more sense than going to get a Fromm or an Eason in the third round or maybe even the fourth round. The one caveat I guess I will say is they have the luxury of these three fourth-round picks. If a Fromm or Eason that you have valued maybe as a third-round guy slips to that fourth round, would you be willing to take a flyer on it? I would say no, but value is value, so you never know.
Well, and then also keep in mind, too, I'm not sure actually what Gruden believes in. If Gruden has two quarterbacks or three quarterbacks on a game day roster, probably something I should probably look into. But keep in mind as well, where if you do take a guy like Easton and Fromm, and maybe you want to practice squad him because you want to save that roster spot, well, then another team can sign him right away. So then you're kind of behind the eight ball a little bit, because if another team offers to sign him, the Jaguars have a choice to sign them, so then you have to sign him to your active roster, and then you have three quarterbacks on your game day, which I'm not sure if that's what Gruden believes in or not. So
we're going to take a break. When we come back, Todd, hang on the line. I think he's still there, or maybe he hung up. But I think he had a question about the quarterbacks as well. Get you out on the other side of this timeout. We'll keep that conversation going. More Jags talk here on Action Sports Jax on Essential ESPN 690.
Men, are the effects of hypertension, diabetes, or prostate cancer preventing you from having a satisfying love life? In just one visit, the doctors at Prime Men's Medical Center can help you overcome ED or PE to regain your confidence and have you last longer in the bedroom. Name brand pills don't work for many men and can have serious side effects. The highly skilled physicians at Prime Men's Medical Center provide custom blended medications that are safe, effective, and work immediately, regardless of your medical history or age. You'll see results on your first visit, guaranteed, or your consultation is free. So, if you have problems in the bedroom, call now for a private consultation. One call, one visit, one simple solution to regain your love life. Call Prime Men's Medical Center now at 904-206-8105. 904-206-8105. That's 904-206-8105.
Every day, new information comes out about the coronavirus. At Action News Jax, we want you to know that we're on top of every new development. And every day, we're talking to experts, uncovering new information, and sharing what we're learning with you.
I'm Action News Jax anchor Tanika Hughes. ActionNewsJax.com is filled with valuable information on the impacts to Florida and Georgia. Stay calm, stay with us, and stay informed.
Action News Jax is local coverage you can count on.
It's time for some straight talk. You know what a full court press is in basketball, right? Full defensive coverage with no holes. Well, that's the kind of coverage you get with Straight Talk Wireless. It runs on America's best 4G LTE networks, same as the big carriers, but just for a lot less. Just $45 a month gets you the unlimited plan with 25 gigs of high-speed data, then 2G, saving you up to half the cost of the big carriers. No contract. Full court coverage, half the cost. Straight Talk Wireless. Everything for less. Savings may vary. See terms and conditions at straighttalk.com.
Trade Pros. Ferguson is committed to making business with us the easiest part of your day. Ferguson.com is designed to help run your business from the office to the job site by making your day-to-day activities easier with 24/7 account access, unmatched online inventory, and on-the-go account management. And with our Pro Plus customer loyalty program, you can earn points with every online purchase, redeemable for merchandise, event tickets, trips, and more. Sign up today at Ferguson.com.
Broadcasting live from the ESPN 690 Anna Jahr and Levine Studios. Anna Jahr and Levine Accident Attorneys. Call 904-600-4000. That's 904-600-4000. ESPN 690, Jacksonville's home for ESPN Radio. WOKV Jacksonville. Listen live everywhere you go on ESPN690.com. ESPN 690, a Cox Media Group station.
Brent Martineau.
You see him every day on CBS 47, Fox 30, Action Sports Jax.
Austin Lane.
He's a former Jag star and current MMA fighter.
Broadcasting live from the Anna Jahr and Levine Studio.
This is Action Sports Jax on ESPN 690 and ESPN690.com.
I don't think we're going to play NBA basketball again this year. I don't see it happening. I don't see Major League Baseball happening. And I see the NFL and college football starting late. Because I don't know how you feel, but until there's a protocol or a vaccine, what happens when you start up again, the next person comes down with the virus? Do you suspend play again or you just let it go? I think the fear with everyone concerned is going to be palpable even once we come back.
That's Van Gundy talking about the NBA season. You know, I have a hard time disagreeing with anybody that believes that kind of stuff right now. I mean, you can have that
take.
Can't
deny it, man.
I just can't get that far down the road. And I don't know the NBA much in terms of, could they truncate the playoffs? Could they try to find a champion? I feel like they will try their darndest to play. But what not many people are talking about, and this has crossed my mind, is could they actually – this affect two seasons? So they truncate this season where they don't play the end of the regular season, so they play the playoffs,
yeah.
Which, by the way, in the NBA take forever. But maybe even they try to find a way to speed that up a little bit. But then because they don't finish – say they didn't finish that until September,
mm-hmm.
or October. Well, that's when camps start. Is like October.
Mm.
Like that's when the NBA season reboots.
Yeah.
Well, maybe they don't reboot until January, and they actually shrink down you know, who was the one guy that had made the proposal of like 50 games in a season or something? Well, maybe in 2021 they do that. So it actually impacts two seasons, but you find a champion in both seasons. You still have your playoffs in both seasons. And again, I'm still not out of the question here that this could be the way new way of doing things in sports like Major League Baseball and the NBA.
I just think it's going to be a shame if the NBA season is officially canceled, because obviously with Kobe Bryant and everything, the LA Lakers are making their run. Could they do it for Kobe Bryant? And then obviously the answer is probably going to be no, because they went 49-14, and unfortunately the Milwaukee Bucks have a better record. So you'd obviously give the championship to the Milwaukee Bucks, and then we'd have a nice victory parade, a victory celebration here on ESPN 690 for my team. So I don't want to win like that, Brent, but if it comes down to it and the season gets canceled, I guess you're Milwaukee Bucks NBA champions. So
you'll have the parade. Hey, Todd's hanging on the line. Let's talk quarterbacks real quick. What's up, Todd? How you doing, man?
I'm doing good, man. How are you guys doing?
We're good.
Good.
I had a take on the picks on the first round. I was thinking if it's possible to address offense and defense, like maybe picking CeeDee Lamb with the first pick and then trading up to get Kinlaw and then picking a cornerback maybe in the second round, try to help address the run defense, the defensive backs, and give Gardner another offensive weapon with some elite talent there. What do you guys think about it?
Todd, I hire you as GM, man. Thanks for the call. Action Sports Shaq's on ESPN 690. Thanks for listening as well. Listen, I love, first of all, I think Todd's all over it. I mean, that's fine. Mm-hmm. Again, I don't believe the MO of this football team has been to pick a wide receiver with that ninth overall pick. I'm fine if you want to do it. It helps my quarterback. Mm-hmm. It helps me be dynamic on offense. I mean, I would be in love with the idea of it. I think it makes you different. Like, I don't feel the Jags are different if they pick Derrick Brown or if they pick Javon Kinlaw. Are they better? Yes. But are they different than they've been? I mean, for the last 12 years, their defense has been kind of the mainstay. They could run the football, mm-hmm. whether it's Fred Taylor, Maurice Jones-Drew, or now Leonard Fournette. I'm not saying they can run it every year, but they can run the football. And they can play solid defense, sometimes elite defense, but they can play solid defense. And what Doug Marrone's trying to do is stop the run, right? They're trying to be better at that. They've, in the last few years, have been awesome against the pass for the most part. Well, not so much against the run, especially the last two seasons. They're trying to change that. So I'm not saying those guys don't make you better, but it doesn't make you different than you've been. Like, well, I want to see something different, man. I want to see something dynamic.
Brent, be honest, Josh Allen has made you different. Okay, Josh Allen has impacted you in a big way. Yeah. I'm not saying Kinlaw or Derrick Brown are going to be Josh Allen, but I'm just saying if you can get a bona fide three technique, it makes a difference. It really does.
Okay. You know, again, you're not wrong in terms of there's probably a little bit of a wall here that I'm building. Here's what I would say. Josh Allen is fantastic, but Josh Allen was awesome. Okay. He's going to be awesome.
For sure.
He makes you different. You're right. He makes you different, I think, if you have Yannick Ngakoue, because you have two 25-year-old or younger pass rushers, and that nobody else has in the league. So that's a way to be different. But if you look at the last few years, and now this is a little different than maybe the Jags have been historically, because they've had trouble finding pass rushers, quite mm-hmm. frankly. But Calais Campbell in 2017, sorry.
They're good.
2017, if you look at them, they had Dante Fowler, Yannick Ngakoue, Calais Campbell, man. I mean, Josh Allen just kind of fits in that mold of what they've had. So they've been able to get after the passer mm-hmm. on third down. When they were super good, they could stop the run and they could stop the pass.
Mm-hmm.
I just don't know, unless they switch to a 3-4 on defense, right?
Yep.
Unless they get Isaiah Simmons and mm-hmm. say, you know what, we don't care where this guy plays. We're gonna fit him. Mm-hmm. We're gonna find a spot. We're gonna be dynamic. Then I don't feel like you're really doing that much different with the defense. That's my point about like a Judy or a Lamb or somebody like that. I feel like if you got that guy and you have DJ Chark and you brought in Tyler Eifert mm-hmm. and you have Minshew, who's this fun guy, you don't really know exactly what he is. Well, that makes you about as different than any team I've covered with the Jacksonville Jaguars. The Jaguars have not had that. Mm-hmm. They did not have that kind of dynamic personality on offense with Foles when he was starting the year, with Bortles for 5 years, with Gabbert for the other years, and even with David Garrard. They were a run team. They couldn't really ever beat you that deep. Allen Robinson and Allen Hurns had a nice year, you know, the 1 year combined. But that's it. They've never – there's not one football team in the league that scouted the Jaguars and said we're worried about them throwing the football today. They haven't done that since Jimmy Smith played here, since 2005.
Sure. And I agree with you. And listen, if they take CeeDee Lamb or Judy, I wouldn't be mad at it, okay? I would actually probably welcome it because it gives another weapon to Gardner Minshew, and that's what you want. But once again, on the hierarchy of needs right now in the first round, like, for instance, let's do an exercise real quick. AFC South. Who, okay, out of the Colts, the Texans, the Titans, and the Jacksonville Jaguars, who has the best receiving core right now?
Okay, you get T.Y., Hilton, and whatever. Colts, you have no longer Hopkins, but you get Fuller, who's always hurt.
Yep, and you got Kiki. I think Kukudi's gone, and Stills.
But Stills.
Yeah.
I mean, listen, I would say in a game planning sense, I would say Houston still concerns you the most, partly because of their quarterback.
But I'm saying just from the wide receivers. I'm not saying don't put the quarterback into it. I'm just saying from a wide receiver standpoint.
I think Fuller's dangerous when healthy. I mean, he's
Brent, the guy. But you even said yourself, the guy never plays, man.
I know, yeah. But he's. You got to assume they're going to have him.
And I can say DJ Chark's dangerous. He's a Pro Bowler. Fuller's not. You mean to tell me
you're going to put me in a spot where I say you're going to put me in a spot where I'm going to have to like badmouth DJ Chark?
I guess so, man. I don't know. I thought DJ Chark was obvious. I thought this was obvious, but I guess not.
Dangerous? Like I don't know if teams are looking at that on film. I mean, I think people look at Will Fuller on film. Listen, I haven't been a fan of Houston at all.
You haven't been a fan of Will Fuller either.
I'm just being honest. Like I do this from the sense of how do I scout you? What do I game plan for you?
Sure.
I think that's what we don't talk about enough. Right? Like Josh Allen might regress a little bit this year stat-wise. You know why? Because people are going to game plan for him.
Oh, yeah.
They know he's a beast.
Have fun with those double teams now.
DJ Chark will have to battle things.
Sure.
Because they might game plan for him a little bit more and take away that number one option. But I think Will Fuller's a horrific matchup for a lot of teams because of his speed and his ability. And so I go from a game like T.Y. Hilton has lost a step, right, because of the injuries.
T.Y. Hilton's still legit.
But he's a guy you game plan for.
Once again, as wide receivers, though, who else do they have, Brent?
Yeah, I'd say the Jags overall are better than the Colts. I wasn't going to not say that.
And then all the Tennessee Titans, A.J. Brown, Corey Davis, nah. Sharp, I think he's gone. So I'd probably take the Jaguars over the Tennessee Titans as well right now with what they have.
I like the guys. I really don't like badmouth in the group because I think it's a pretty good group, but I just don't know if it's a scary group.
I'm just trying to put things in perspective right now. You know, like in the grand scheme of things and in the landscape of things, I get it, okay? Where last year, if we were to rank the wide receiving group and we had DJ Chark, DD Westbrook, and Chris Conley coming in, I think we would all agree, man, 31st maybe in the NFL, like, it didn't look good on paper, okay? Well, we may have some here with DJ Chark now. DD Westbrook had an offseason last year. He may, you know, obviously go up to another echelon with a new offensive coordinator and another year of Gardner Minshew. I'm just saying, even in the AFC South right now, it's hard to count out the Jacksonville Jaguars and maybe being the favorites and wide receivers just because, once again, Will Fuller cannot stay healthy. Kenny Stills, he's all right. So Houston's okay. Tennessee, all they have is Corey Davis. And in Indianapolis, really all they have, I mean, they have Jack Doyle, if you want to count tight ends as receivers. I can say that Jaguars got Tyler Eifert right now. And then you got Jack Doyle and you got T.Y. Hilton. Besides that, I think the Jaguars right now are sitting pretty good. But you can always upgrade.
Let me play your game. Then.
Play my game, man.
Let's play a game.
Saw style. Yeah, let's go.
Okay.
Yeah.
I got a little combative there.
Saw style. I like this.
But anyway, so to go where you want to go with this topic.
Let's go there.
I would say, okay, the Jags have the best AFC, best group in the AFC South.
Mm-hmm.
In the AFC South.
Sorry, Chiefs.
Sorry, Chargers, Chiefs. So what does that mean, though? So what are you saying? Then you don't need to do anything with that position because of that?
Not saying that whatsoever. And I was very adamant of saying, like, listen, if they get a wide receiver the first round, I would be excited for Gardner Minshew because you want to give him the tools. But I'm just saying I think people are panicking and saying that they don't have a lot of talent at the wide receiver position. They have to upgrade. Yeah, I agree you have to upgrade because of Gardner Minshew, give him the best weapons possible. But I think on the grand scheme of things, it's not as bad as some people think it is.
Yeah, and I would agree with that. It's kind of the way their receiving group, in a sense, follow me here now.
Following.
Many people are going to agree with this. But in a sense, it's kind of how the Jags feel about their offensive line. Like, they like the pieces of their offensive line. They do, way more than other people. But I can't sit here and tell you that I hate their pieces of their offensive line. Mm-hmm. I like Juwan Taylor. To me, Juwan Taylor would be the DJ Chark of the group. He's, like, got star potential. And he had a good year. Now, he's 1 year behind him in terms of how long he's played in the NFL. But I think Linder would be, like, again, Linder for his – you've got to understand and get by that Linder, I think, is respected around the league – and he's now in the middle class of centers in terms of paychecks. Mm-hmm. He was this highest paid guy and didn't play all the time and all that stuff. You got to get that out of your mind. Mm-hmm. In 2020, he is coming off a nice year, people think, people say, some, depends who you talk to. But again, he's middle of the pack in terms of pay. Mm-hmm. And so I don't know, was he D.D. Westbrook in terms of their wide receiver group? Norwell is the guy that many people believe is overpaid, but he's also above average in terms of the position. He might just not be as good as he's getting paid.
Yeah.
And then we have no idea about Cam Robinson yet. It's like Cam Robinson, maybe Cam Robinson's the DD. You know, he's like, he's had moments, but he hasn't had enough of moments. You know what I mean? So I guess the Jags feel that way, but that doesn't, what, again, you're trying to change your team, I think. You're trying to become the best that you can be on offense, especially, I believe, right now. And I think Todd's point of getting like a Judy early on or a Lamb early on, the more I talk about it out loud, makes them as dynamic as they've been. Dynamic in my dozen years of covering them as I've seen mm-hmm. on paper on the offensive end. They got a quarterback that can be fun as hell. He can run around. He can do some things. And now you've got a Pro Bowl tight end. I know you're risking the injury part, but you've got him on paper. I'm talking paper. You've got D.D. Westbrook, who I still think they haven't untapped all of his potential. You have D.J. Chark, who could be a rising star. You have, by all accounts, the Judys and Lambs of the world are going to be studs in this league. Mm-hmm. You can't find people to say they won't. And so now, and by the way, that leaves Fournette. And it kind of goes back to our conversation of, well, now you don't have to do everything with Fournette. You actually make Fournette maybe even better because you've got other people that people have to pay attention to. So is it the utmost need? No, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Does it make you dynamic and more dynamic than you were last year and have ever been? Maybe more than any other selection you could make.
Well, and that's fair. Because I can point to A.J. Brown last year. I can point to D.J. Metcalf. I can point to Andy Isabella. And they have changed their teams, right? Now, Quinnen Williams, top three pick, defensive tackle, didn't really change his team that much, okay? A lot of guys, I think, in the top 10 didn't really necessarily change their teams. The wide receivers did, though. So I agree with you there. I guess what I'm trying to say is, do I want the Jaguars to take a wide receiver? I wouldn't be mad at it. I think it would be fun to cover. I think Jaguars fans would be excited for that. But I'm just saying, if it doesn't happen, I'm not going to be disappointed because of what they have right now.
I feel you. Yeah. I hear that. And I can see the logic. That's why I don't think they're taking one, right? Yeah. Because logic says kind of what you're saying. But I think you really got to be careful in this league to say we're all set at a spot. And we feel good about a spot. I think you got to be careful of that.
You can always get better.
Injuries change everything in a heartbeat. Mm-hmm. DJ Chark goes down. Now how do you feel about that group?
Oh. Yeah, probably the same way I feel about the Houston Texans right now without DeAndre Hopkins. Yeah.
You know, I actually said this thing to my kids the other day. I said, hey, you got to know what you're good at and know what you're bad at, but you take what you're good at and don't sit on it and be great at it and then try to fix what you're not so great at, right? Yeah. I mean, that's kind of like what you do. Well, the Jags think they're pretty good at wide receiver. Well, then be great at it.
Sure.
Why not? Listen, like, that is not a bad idea.
I say be great at it, Brent, but I also look at your defensive line right now. And from my standpoint, if you don't take a defensive lineman at number 9 or number 20 in the first round, then I'm upset.
Okay, but that,
then I'm worried.
Yeah, well, Todd, and so Todd, let's go back to Todd's question. Yes. His question was, could you fix both? Could you break offense in that first pick and then defense in the second pick and trade up to get kicked? Because now there is no doubt. Well, I shouldn't say there's no doubt. It doesn't seem like there's doubt in the mock draft minds that you're going to have to trade up to get a Kinlaw or a Brown. They're not staying until 20.
No.
Early on this process, Kinlaw was kind of a slippery guy to number 20 potentially.
Correct.
Because well, that's not happening.
Yep.
In fact, I've seen a lot more people saying Derek Brown could slip down to like number 13 or 14. And a lot more of these mock drafts. Again, it just depends what you believe. But I don't I like what he said. I first of all think that corner in round two makes more sense to me than round one, unless it's Okuda.
Yeah.
Okuda's where I stop and be like, okay, that's Josh Allen. Like, I'm getting Josh Allen. I don't need that right now at number nine, I don't think.
For sure.
But wait a minute. I'm not passing that up. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, I wait till round two because I think there's depth there to get.
One last thing you want to do is trying to, like, I guess, reach up to try to get your guy to fit the position, right? Yeah. Especially when you have a lot of needs. So, yeah, yeah, and, like, I can agree with
that. CJ Henderson's not going to be available. I just think that it gets a little more muddled up between, say, 15 and 45 on the draft board. And so I think you're okay picking at number 42 as a corner. But the question is, and this is something I've wanted them to do so many different times, when you pick in the top 10, and this is the year, by the way, they finally have some real capital to do it. Mm-hmm. But I wanted them to come back in and go and step up more. Like, a lot of people want to trade down.
But
I want them to jump back into that first round. Well, they have a second pick. That's at number 20. So what if you took that number 20 and you jump up to number 15? Mm-hmm. And that was Todd's point. Mm-hmm. You know, could you jump up to number 13? Now you just got the 9th and the 13th picks. And you had to give stuff up for it, but you got 12 picks.
You have a lot of
and
capital to do.
Actually, next year you have some even more. Yeah. You have 9 picks next year. So I would love to see the Jags be aggressive in that sense and give me two top 15 players. I would really like that. Like, that fascinates me. In years past, I thought at times, and they almost did this, oh, gosh, who would it have been? I can't remember the guy. They were so close to jumping back in with. It was a couple years back. Dang it, I don't know. I might be thinking, I'm not thinking of the Miles Jack part, but that was another example of it.
Yeah.
Miles Jack in 16, I'm like sitting there in, we're in Chicago at the draft, and I'm like, oh, come back up and get him.
Get him.
He's like slipping. He's down to like, no. Now remember, you think, I was a little biased. I thought Miles Jack was the best player in the draft.
I was with you, man.
And so I'm like, wow, he's at 27.
Oh, I know.
He's at,
I'm
like, 28. It's like, jump back in. Get him.
Yeah.
Well, they got fortunate. They could wait till the second round, and then I think they made a minor trade up to like number 34 or something like that. But I love that. Like, I think that's good because I think there is a big difference. Like, again, I kind of cut it off around the top 40 or 45 picks and then the rest of the picks. I think there is a difference there.
Yeah.
And I don't know if it's just because we know the names better, if we hear the names. But I do think there's a difference. And there's probably a big difference between number 16 and 45. You know, so that top half of the first round, if the Jags in this situation could pick number 9, then take that 20th pick and something else and package it and move up to number 13 or 14 and do what Todd says, I would be in love with the idea of that. I'm not telling you it will work. I'm not telling you they'll pick the right guy. I just love the idea of doing that with the amount of draft capital the Jags have.
But keep in mind, though, here, Brent. So say they do that. So say the Jaguars are at number 9. Let's say they take they get Derek Brown. Okay, they got Derek Brown, and maybe you got some wide receivers. Judy's still available, possibly. You got CeeDee Lamb, and all of a sudden, you know, I think, let's say the Jets at number 11 are on the clock again. All of a sudden, what's this trade? Jacksonville Jaguars trade is in, and they move up to take a guy like Andrew Thomas
or Wirfs,
Will Wirfs. What does that do for you now, though? Because to me, that doesn't.
It doesn't. I get what you're saying. It doesn't feel. But
let's be honest. Like, if they do that, they gotta love that, right? Like,
they love it.
If they trade up to get Wirfs or whoever offensive lineman, it's like they see something in that guy that obviously we don't see because it's the offensive lineman. But do you like it from your perspective?
I would.
Okay.
I would.
Okay.
Because here's the thing, I think if the Jags take an offensive lineman in the first round, they see that as a significant upgrade over Cam Robinson. See, my view on Cam Robinson is I still don't know exactly what he is. And when you don't know somebody is in 3 years in, I guess that's a little bit of an issue. That's a red flag. But I haven't given up on Cam Robinson. But if I think Wirfs is the guy, and I just can't rate offensive linemen, but I'm just saying if they do, and that's how they value him, and a lot of people do value him in that sense, that he is an anchor to your offensive line for the next 6 to 10 years, well, then I have no problem whatsoever. I view that tackle position as the second best chance for the Jags to become better quickly on offense and for the longer term on offense. I say wide receiver would be first because it's obvious and I can keep track of stats, but I think that left tackle is the most upgradable possible position for the Jaguars. They already have it. They don't need it, but they could become more dynamic. They could become more special in that regard. So I wouldn't have a problem with it. They'd get me excited about the Lambs or Ruggs or somebody like that in the moment, like you're talking about. but I think it would make a lot of sense. And I think that would fit also what Todd's talking about. Mm-hmm. Can you get an offensive guy and a defensive guy? And I guess if I went back to what I said way back, like way in the middle of last year or toward the end of last season, I really thought the Jags, my initial thought on what they would do 4, 5, 6 months ago was they would, I said, give me anybody that's over 300 pounds.
Yeah.
That's essentially what I said. They need big. Mm-hmm. They need to get bigger and beefier on the offensive line and bigger and beefier and better on the defensive line.
Well, instead you got Black Panther, which isn't a bad thing.
Yeah. With Josh Allen, but they need more of it.
Yeah.
And so if they did that in with their first two selections, whether it's 9 and 20 or they traded up and 9 and 14, or I'm not going to criticize.
Okay.
I think those would be – I think it would be a smart move to do that. I will just shuffle back to the early part of our conversation with wide receiver, and the more we talk about it, if you want to be bold, if you want to be different, if you want to be more dynamic is the only word I can come up with, mm-hmm. the thing that makes you as different as you've been maybe in a decade is going to get one of those receivers mm-hmm. and having a couple of guys in a deep move and making that receiving room as good as it can be for your young quarterback mm-hmm. and finding out what you have. I think that's the most dynamic thing they can do in this draft outside of trading up for an Okuda or something like that.
Yeah.
And I don't think they're going to do it. Mm-hmm. But it would be pretty fun to watch.
So I think, in conclusion, you know, to try to put a bow on it a little bit, I think we've established that obviously the wide receiver, that's a sexy position. If you can do that, then more power to you. It's going to make the fans excited. But, you know, from people that cover like you and I, if the Jaguars do trade up, you know, and try to get maybe like an Andrew Thomas, like we said, or maybe a Wirfs from Iowa, even if they get an offensive tackle, the fact that they're, you know, they're making moves, right? They're trying to take, quote unquote, their guys. They see something special. You have to like that as well, right? Because let's be honest, right now I think the ship, it's kind of going down with Doug Marrone and Dave Caldwell. I mean, this is a must-win season, and at least if the ship's going down, they're going to be swinging until they go down, right? And that's the point of trading up. So I think I agree with you when I say I don't care who they take if they trade up, Brent. I'm sorry, if they actually do trade up.
Listen, you have if I'm being completely honest, and you have to really check yourself on this one, okay? Really two of them. But take two of the worst trade-up moves the Jags have made.
Oh, Blaine Gabbert.
Blaine Gabbert and Derek Harvey.
Yeah.
So they moved up and they made it didn't turn out. But again, you've got to put yourself back in time a little bit. Now, before you knew it wasn't going to work out. Mm-hmm. And if I'm being completely honest with myself, I loved the fact that they traded up and went after those guys. I give Gene Smith credit for going to, and being aggressive to go get guys that he thought
well, especially
were
at the quarterback position, man.
And especially at the franchise quarterback spot. Yeah. So,
did Gene have Harvey, or was that?
That actually might have been Shaq.
Okay.
Would have been 08. I think that was Shaq.
Okay.
That's a good call. So, listen, I know what you're saying. It's like, yeah, well, it wasn't a very smart move. I get it. I get
hindsight's
it.
Hindsight's 20/20.
But I'm just saying, if you have the conviction in your draft room that this guy is going to be this good, that he's worth going to spend some draft capital on, I respect that. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of people thought the Atlanta Falcons were crazy for going to get Julio Jones and giving up that load of draft picks.
Yeah.
Well, Julio Jones has been pretty damn good.
Yeah.
You know, and it didn't win him a Super Bowl, but it should have won him a Super Bowl. It should have.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, and even, especially the quarterback's position. You know, like RG3. Look at what the Redskins gave up to get him. And I get it. Injuries happen. That's not RG3's fault. But keep in mind, he took him to the playoffs. Okay? I mean, you know, he was limping on one leg in the playoffs, but he was there.
No, you're right. Listen,
he again, turned that team around a little
like
bit.
Like, the Trubisky one's different. Trubisky made no sense. Like, nobody was drafting Trubisky, and they had to wait one more pick.
Yeah.
Like, that made zero sense to me.
Mm-hmm.
Like, but, I mean, do you appreciate the fact that they were not going to take even a chance that somebody else went and got him? Do you appreciate, I guess, a little part of me, but it almost seems that was a little bit kamikaze style.
Well,
that was like, that was careless. That was reckless.
Well, and let's look at the two of the most prime examples. Obviously, the Baltimore Ravens, Lamar Jackson. I mean, you traded up, you know, to the 29th pick or whatever it was. I'm like, ooh, ballsy. We get it. But you still got him, so props to you for doing that. But the Kansas City Chiefs. Straight up to number 10 to get Patrick Mahomes because that was their guy. Andy Reid loved Patrick Mahomes, and they went after him.
To be honest with you, okay, and again, it's not really bad.
Yeah.
But the Jags going to get Blaine Gabbert from 16 to 10. in that draft. I think the Chiefs were 14-10. They jumped up, I think. I don't know for sure.
Yeah, yeah.
But I want to say it was that. There's really no difference. Jags had David Garrard, who was their veteran guy. And again, Chiefs the difference is the Chiefs had Alex Smith, who I think his resume would have proved better. I mean, he was at that time a pretty good quarterback before the injuries. So, but the situation, again, is not that different, where they had a veteran guy, and the Jags said, you know what? It's time to look toward the future, and we think this guy's the best guy on the board, and we're going to get him at number 10. We're going to do it. Well, Kansas City said the same thing, and there were not a lot of folks that seemed that way about Patrick Mahomes. They were convicted, and they could have easily been just as wrong. Easily could have been just as wrong. They weren't.
Yeah. I'm going to be honest here, man. I'm sitting here. I'm talking about to you right now. My heart rate is rising at an extremely fast pace.
Your heart rate is rising. I'm defending Gene Smith.
But here's why it's off the charts right now. Because I'm trying to play out scenarios, and I'm playing out mock drafts. Who's to say that maybe Gruden, maybe Doug Marrone or somebody in that office, maybe even Dave Caldwell, looks at Tua Tagovailoa and says, this is our guy. Like, yeah, we had something special in Garner, like we have, you know, like we had something good with Alex Smith in Kansas City, but we see Patrick Mahomes. We see Tua Tagovailoa, and we got to make that move. That's where I'm nervous at, Brent.
Well, it's their job. Don't be nervous.
Palms are sweaty.
It's their job to do that if they see that.
Yeah.
Again, I said this yesterday on the show, though. I'm not sure I would allow that if I'm Shad Khan. I'm serious. And the reason, if you missed yesterday's show, you can go back and listen to it more at length. But YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, Twitch, Action Sports Jacks on ESPN 690 podcast.
Boom.
It's a good time to get that in.
Nailed it.
You can listen and watch from home while you work from home. But
essential.
The reason I say if I was Shad Khan, I would think about it. I don't know if he would do it, but I would think about stepping in on that. Is one, I like Gardner Minshew if I'm Shad Khan.
You should.
I love everything about him. I like the business side of him. I like the Jaguar King t-shirts. I like everything about Gardner Minshew. And I need to, for my peace of mind, to sleep at night, find out if he is special.
Yes.
So that's what this season's about. And then the other side of it, again, if I'm Shad Khan, I'm saying, listen, there is a real chance I fire this group of coaches. That's reality. They might not survive to 2021. Am I going to say Jay Gruden or Doug Marrone or Dave Caldwell fell in love with Tua so much they went up and got him? Well, next year, as I'm bringing in a new staff, what if that staff doesn't like Tua?
Yeah.
Well, no, now I've got Gardner Minshew, who's just whatever, and now I've got Tua. This guy they don't even like. Well, now my job might not be as appealing, and I got to go get another quarterback and invest in it again. So
you've got heart rate decreasing.
So that's why I think quarterback up that high. Again, I'm talking from Shad Khan's vantage point.
Yeah.
I'm the owner of the team right now, and I'm saying we ain't picking quarterback. I don't care if you think he's Joe Montana.
Yeah.
Now that might be a mistake too, but I'm just saying my mindset. I don't care if he's Joe Montana.
Yeah.
You're not picking him. I am seeing what I have, and I'll put this. If it's not doesn't work out. Well, our next regime in 2021 is 9 draft picks and 2 first rounders, and we'll make those decisions on QBs.
Well, that's the thing. I mean, Tua could be Joe Montana, but you might have Tom Brady, you know, in your backyard. You got to find out.
You've got to find out. Very good point. Fun conversation there. Thanks for the calls, Todd and Steven earlier. Keep the calls coming, 904-362-9901. Love when you jump in on the conversation. I think there's a lot to think about. These things are real deal things to think about, and the Jags are in an interesting spot. You have to give them a lot of credit for right now what they've been able to do to think ahead to 2021, even though their jobs are on the line. You appreciate that part of it. But what mentality prevails in the draft coming up in a few weeks will be very interesting to see. Brent Martin, Austin Lane, Coos here on a Wednesday. We continue the football talk and more, including have you caught the Christian Dawkins documentary coming up on ESPN 690.
Action Sports Jax with Brent Martineau on ESPN 690 is brought to you by Best Bet Jacksonville and Orange Park.
Now, the First Alert forecast on ESPN 690. A good deal of sun, breezy and cooler today. Highs in the low 70s, dropping all the way down into the 40s tonight, and mostly sunny and nice tomorrow. Your Thursday high, 77. Join me beginning at 5 p.m. for CBS 47 and Fox 30 Action News Jax from the First Alert Weather Center. I'm Chief Meteorologist Mike Burrish.
Jacksonville Truck Center is here to help you get in the truck you deserve. When you need a fleet vehicle, Jacksonville Truck Center has the largest selection of pre-owned commercial vehicles, including cargo vans and work trucks. We're here to make it easy for you. There's commercial or personal financing available, even if you have bad credit. Don't spend your tax return money anywhere else. Visit the new Jacksonville Truck Center on Arlington Expressway next to the Southside Connector or online at jacksonvilletruckcenter.com.
This is a CMG Open for Business report. During these changing times, it's challenging for businesses across North Florida, big and small. But businesses are adjusting to meet your needs in a safe and comfortable way. Here's today's list of businesses that are open for you. Title Max, Peak Roofing and Construction, AC Design, Pizza Hut, SAS Bearings, Perry's Alignment. If you're open for business, let us know by emailing us at openjax@cmg.com. Together, we're getting through this.
After a long day, having my dogs meet me at the door with their silly smiles and wagging tails makes me happy. I want to keep that joy with me for years to come. That's why I trust Forever Vets Animal Hospital to keep my pets healthy. Forever Vets was voted 2019's Best Vet in Jacksonville Magazine's Readers Poll, and it's easy to see why. The affordable wellness plans are tailored to meet all of your pets' changing needs as they grow. Open 7 days a week, Forever Vets friendly staff is available to treat you and your pet with care. They combine extended hours with online booking to allow you to give your pet quality care while accommodating your schedule. Go online to forevervets.com to find which of their 8 offices is nearest you. And don't forget the newest location in Riverside, Forever Vets Animal Hospital, keeping your pets happy and healthy forever.
I'm Josh Scobie, proud supporter of the Guardian Catholic Schools, where we believe that every child deserves access to a quality, faith-based education. For over 22 years, Guardian Catholic Schools have served as a critical, high-impact presence within Jacksonville's educational landscape. From our highly acclaimed Early Learning Center and K-8 classrooms, every student is prepared with critical thinking skills and confidence as our educators build a foundation for their lifelong success. In fact, more than 96% of our alumni go on to graduate high school, higher than our local and state average. All students attending Guardian Catholic School receive some level of financial assistance. Regardless of where they begin, we know that all children can be successful. For more information on how you can help protect the potential of these bright students, visit guardiancatholicschools.org or call 904-765-1920 to schedule a tour. Guardian Catholic Schools, protecting potential.
It's the home of the Action Sports Jacks Dream 18, and it can be your home course as well. The golf club at Southampton in North St. Johns County, located off County Road 210, family-owned and operated, and a fun course to play. The golf club at Southampton offers club membership programs starting at just $79. With its elite practice facility and player-friendly golf course design, it will be your gateway to a great time with the family or with your buddies. Become a member in 2020. For more information, call the golf club at Southampton at 904-287-PLAY.
Hello, I'm Chuck Barnes. At Barnes & Cohen, we're pulling out all the stops to protect your health and ours. We have the latest software that enables our staff who are at high risk to work remotely without sacrificing first-class representation. Our offices remain open. We have a sanitized conference room, but maybe your best option, meet us here in our courtyard. Barnes & Cohen will continue to serve you in the safest way possible.
Slip and falls can be embarrassing, leaving you in pain and feeling like you've lost control. I'm Ellie Anajar from the law offices of Anajar & Levine. After a fall, document the scene by taking photographs and make sure to get medical attention for any injuries you may have. If you've been injured in a slip and fall accident, call the law offices of Anajar & Levine at 904-600-4000. That's 904-600-4000 for a free consultation. And take back control of your life.
Office in Jacksonville.
This is a CMG Open for Business report. During these changing times, it's challenging for businesses across North Florida, big and small. But businesses are adjusting to meet your needs in a safe and comfortable way. Here's today's list of businesses that are open for you. Armstrong Fence, CompuClinic, Rosalia's Italian Restaurant, Just Brew It, Desserts, Tony's Pizza. If you're open for business, let us know by emailing us at openjax@cmg.com. Together, we're getting through this.
Hey, boss, check out this headline. Safe Touch Security. Your health and safety are all we do.
Safe Touch again? Is that all you ever talk about?
Boss, your mom still has a Safe Touch security system, right?
That is correct. Don't make any comments.
No, I can't blame you. Having a Safe Touch system is like having a halo of protection surrounding her.
Exactly. For instance, let's say, God forbid, that she needed the fire department.
Not to worry, Safe Touch can respond.
Or let's say she stubbed her toe, the mother of all toe stubs, and she couldn't get to the phone.
Safe Touch can contact emergency toe fixes.
I never thought I'd say this, but I'm glad Safe Touch is out there.
Boss!
I know, but that doesn't mean we don't stick to the Crooks of Us motto. Stay away from Safe Touch houses.
Crooks know to stay away from Safe Touch houses. Hi, I'm Lester Jackson, president of Safe Touch Security Systems. No one beats our technology or our price.
Call Safe Touch today at 888-723-8682 or go to safetouch.com. State license number EF233.
If you're usually listening to ESPN 690 in your car, but your boss has you working from home this week, well, take us with you. Hey, what's up, everybody? It's Austin Lane from ESPN 690 and Action Sports. Jax, tell Amazon Echo or Google Home, play ESPN 690 and enjoy all that sweet listening coverage.
Brent Martineau.
You see him every day on CBS 47, Fox 30, Action Sports Jax.
Austin Lane.
He's a former Jag star and current MMA fighter.
Broadcasting live from the Anna Jar and Levine studio.
This is Action Sports Jax on ESPN 690 and ESPN690.com.
You know, I'd be lying, or anyone would be lying, if they said that over the last 20 years, a big part of our identity has been centered around Tom and what he's done for us. But again, you know, players come and go. The reality is no player plays forever. So at some point in time, you have to have pillars that you stand upon that are not going to fall regardless of who's in or out. I think we have good pillars in place. I think we'll continue to try to push guys to seek those pillars, stand for those things. And, you know, hopefully that leaves us in a good place as we head into the season and go about the process.
I need better audio in my life. All this Skype and Zoom and all that stuff is killing the audio.
Yeah.
Like, I get it, but...
That gave me another idea.
I can only take...
What do you got?
So much.
Let's take some funny photos of you two, and we'll make a...
Boss me already.
Wait. And we'll make a Zoom background for people to use while on their Zoom meetings, and then ask people to take a screenshot of it.
Hey, Stewart's a team player. Well, because on Zoom, you can put, like, different backgrounds up. I haven't played with it, but you can kind of use different, I would say, filters.
My aunt and uncle are, like, big fans of changing the background and, like, dressing to theme whatever they're doing.
They got a lot of time on their hands.
They're retired.
Yeah.
Well, like, so, for instance, there's, like, a beach background, so you dress up like you're at the beach.
San Francisco. Yeah. Oh, okay. But you can put your own in. Like, Stuart, actually, on the Doug Marrone call yesterday, put the Action Sports Jacks on ESPN 690.
Branding. Smart.
Branding. Very good of Stuart.
Ah, awesome.
He gets a Snickers bar. or an oatmeal raisin cookie like Coach just got.
What a game changer.
But, by the way, that was Matthew Slater, Patriots special teams ace, talking about Tom Brady's departure.
Yeah.
Man, what a feeling in that locker room that will be so different, especially for guys like Slater who have played with him for a long time. Yeah. I mean, that's a big mental hurdle. You know. And, by the way, they got rid of Cody Kessler today. So now they have Stidham and Hoyer on the roster. Does that open up the door for a young quarterback to be drafted? Could be. Does that open up the door for a Cam Newton or Jameis Winston? Could be. Or Andy Dalton type?
Yeah. To me, you would think, I can't believe it's still Nick Foles. I mean, I thought Nick Foles would be the perfect fit there in New England. But yeah, you lose Tom Brady, and the worst part is like, you don't have a replacement. You know, I mean, like, I guess maybe Stidham, who knows? Maybe they like Jared Stidham. Maybe they do. But I just think from being, you know, like a Julian Edelman in that locker room, or just being a vet in that locker room right now, Stephon Gilmore, and it's like we lost Tom Brady and we have Stidham and Brian Hoyer. Like, how pumped are you to be New England Patriot right now? It's honest.
It's like you lost Brady to an ACL.
Yeah, yeah,
it's
exactly.
Like, oh, we were left with that?
Yeah, I mean, one thing if it's like, yeah, we lost Brady, but yeah, we could get, you know, Tua Tagovailoa or somebody like that. Like, that's not probably going to happen. So you look at Brian Hoyer, who, you know, is the journeyman of all journeymen, seems like, and you see Jarrett Stidham, who, I'll be honest, don't really know that much about, and it's just, it's probably not a good feeling right now in that New England locker room.
Yeah, I can't imagine it is, no doubt about it. All right, we have some comments in terms, let's see, Doug says, do Jaguars have the best receiving group in the AFC South? I'm struggling with this one. That's what I tweeted. He said, let me help you. Nope.
who's better?
He didn't say who's better.
Well, come on. Well, this is Doug?
That was Doug, yeah.
Come on, Doug. Who's better?
Doug.
Come on, Doug.
JGiggs09 says, with many holes to fill for the Jags, does it make sense to potentially trade down from 9 or 20 for more draft picks?
Do you want more draft picks?
I know. We're going to be busy. Yeah. We can only fit so many draft picks on a full screen in TV. But listen, I get what you're saying, and I think there's a very good chance the Jaguars could move that number 20 pick down. Mm-hmm. I think they'd be very open to that.
Yeah.
20 down to 25, 26, 27, whatever it might be, pick up another pick, and maybe it's a second rounder or a third rounder. And because of all the draft picks they have, see, this is where I don't get crazy about draft picks. I will give you the first four rounds. So you have two draft picks in the first round, one in the second, one in the third, three in the fourth. Mm-hmm. So that's good. Three, four, seven. Seven picks in the first four rounds.
Yeah.
I'm not saying disregard the fifth, sixth, seventh. But those are more crapshoot picks, man. I mean, you can get Telvin Smith and you can get, you know.
Austin Lane.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I try to stay so humble and so professional on this show, but it's hard sometimes. It's hard sometimes when those fifth round crapshoot picks come down the pipeline for the Jacksonville Jaguars. So hard, Brent.
Yeah, man, I did it again.
Yeah, you're fine, though. You're fine. At least
I'm going to be telling you. I wish
at least you didn't make eye contact this time with me when you said it. Those crapshoot picks.
I wish I would do this on purpose, but it's actually just coming up accidentally.
I'm going to be honest. I feel like you have, like, cue cards where you just kind of go through the whole list every single day, and for whatever reason this day, you felt to really pile it on.
Oh, man.
But yes, anyway. Brent, those good for nothing fifth round picks. I agree.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Good for radio. Yeah. I'll take the top four picks. So you have seven of them. Mm-hmm. So my point being, like, you're not wrong if you can backtrack from number 20 and go to 25 or 26, and maybe you do pick up another third rounder. Well, that's very valuable. I mean, again, Yannick Ngakoue, Brandon Linder, those kind of guys you find in the third round. You know, we'll see about Josh Oliver and those types, but I don't mind the idea of it. So to answer your question, it's not because I need more picks. I got 12 of them. I got seven in the first four rounds. That's pretty good. But more ammunition in rounds two or three, that certainly doesn't hurt.
Yeah. My question, though, is do you take those 12 picks and do you trade up with those picks? Right? Where you have 12 picks, it's like, man, I get it. It's great to have a lot of capital, but at the same time, 12 picks, and maybe you want to plan on half of those guys staying around for a second contract. That's going to be a lot of money going towards your team. So I'm saying, could you visualize them just trading up a bunch of those picks and getting the guys who they truly want?
And that's what I like. See, I like the idea of it, but here's where I think the pickle comes into play. I think a lot of times, if you want to trade up late in the first round or even into the second round, you're going to have to give up the second, probably not a first, but the second rounder or third rounder might be able to give away one of those fourths and package it with some of the fifth or sixth or whatever else. But I do think the Jags want to be aware of being naked in second round and third round.
Okay.
And what I mean by that is they have one pick in each of those rounds. This is too good of a draft in the first three rounds to not have a selection. And so I think they'll be a little careful to give that away. Now, the scenario we played out a little earlier, which, by the way, not so many times I'll sit here and say, hey, that was a fun segment. That was an unbelievable segment. That was a great segment. Yeah. I want to pat ourselves on the back. The last 4 o'clock hour segment was a lot of fun. You know,
it's been a fun day. I've been offended a couple times by you, but it's been a fun day.
Yeah, it's really been a good 45 minutes if you include the offensive part.
Yeah.
But I think what I said is I want 9-20 and then jump back into the first round and even more, or jump 9 or 20 and you jump up to 14 instead of 20. I like that. I think that'd be a lot of fun. And so therefore, would you have, you then have to give up one of those second or third rounders or something like that. And then you could be without a pick in those rounds. I just don't know if they want to do that unless they're getting a bonus selection somewhere. If, again, if they pick two in the top 12, well, they might be willing to say, okay, we don't need that third round pick.
Yeah.
We just got two top 15 guys.
Yeah.
It's really hard to predict and see what they want to do. But I do think the ammunition helps them. And I think they can move either way because they have the amount of picks. And they and going back is always the first option.
Yeah.
More GMs want to go backwards than forwards.
Of course.
Because they do want to gather even more. Josh says a couple of things. I personally wouldn't invest in the wide receiver group until I know I have a QB that can actually use them. We all think, hope Gardner Minshew is that guy. I'd hate to see us hit on a wide receiver in 2020, but watch him waste away without a QB until 2023. Just another star player on their way out. It's a little dangerous with that kind of thinking. I get your point, and that scar tissue on the quarterback front here in Jacksonville,
yeah.
No doubt about it. But that's – nobody is going to think that way in the building. They're not going to think, oh, what if we can't get the fullest potential out of this good player until 2023?
Yeah.
I just don't think they're going to do that. Josh says, bold enough, ? Jax receives Washington's second overall and third round pick. Washington receives the 9th overall and Yannick Ngakoue. Jags take Chase Young and pair him with Josh Allen. Listen, if you could do that, by the way, it's going to take you a lot more than that.
Oh.
It will take Yan. It'll take the 9th pick, and it's going to take at least one of your first round picks next year.
Mm-hmm.
To move up 7 spots in the top 10.
I don't even want to tease myself like that and thinking about Chase Young and Josh Allen. So I'm not going to venture that.
Even if it's that much?
Yeah. this is a moment of silence. I would really think about it. But think about it from this standpoint, guys, okay? This is where I have a hard time with it. Chase Young, maybe he's a Hall of Fame player. Mm-hmm. And pairing him with Josh Allen is great. And think about it now, you got two guys on young deals.
Yeah.
So that's you have two very good players, and they're not costing you a lot of money.
Yeah.
Gives you a ton of flexibility moving forward. Whew. So with that flexibility,
I hope these goosebumps go away.
With that flexibility, I could then be hypocritical here and answer my own, you know, concerns by saying, well, then I'll just go spend some of that money somewhere else and pick up players next year in free agency. Okay, but follow me here. If you give your 9th pick away, well, that's just the trade-off for the 2nd pick.
Correct. Bam.
But you gave away a good player in Yannick Ngakoue, so that's one player down.
Mm-hmm.
And then you're giving up another good player that you think with one of those first-round picks next year.
Mm-hmm.
So you're actually giving up two players for that. Now, two players to slide up. And by the way, I think it would even cost more than that. Like, it would probably cost even a 4th-round pick, too.
Yeah.
But My problem that I have a hard time grasping is in 2020, I've got Yannick Ngakoue. Like, he's on my team. That's one player.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'll have another player next year in the first round as a good player, and I'm still getting a good player at number 9.
Mm-hmm.
So I've got 3 players on my roster that are good players. If I make the move, I only have 1 good player. That's hard for me to digest.
I just heard Koo say Josh Allen and Chase Young, and I just blacked out. Like, I'm just coming back down now. So sorry I didn't really follow along with you, but I agree.
But simply put, it's 3 players versus 1 player.
Yeah, essentially what you're giving up, because you're giving up a first-round pick, right? And you can get a first-round pick for Yannick Ngakoue, we would think. So that's another first-round pick. So, yes, that's a lot at stake for an edge rusher. And would I do it personally? Probably not, but once again, I don't come from the standpoint, I think Yannick Ngakoue is going to be playing next year for the Jacksonville Jaguars.
It's how you feel about it. Yep.
Yeah. I don't, it's a hard one. All I know
that's
now.
That's why I'd like Trent Williams thrown in there.
Yeah.
And if you throw Trent Williams in there, now like you've that. Got another good player.
There you go. Yep, exactly. And then that can kind of throw a hole, possibly, depending what you think about your offensive line. All I know right now, I have a new goal. And listen, in terms of my stats, my stats will never get me to the NFL draft stage where I get to go up there and announce, you know, like the 5th round pick or whatever like that. But my goal now is to make it big in sports media and maybe MMA, where I get my rep up a little bit so people recognize me, so I can go on the stage one day, announce the Jaguars draft pick, and I'm going to announce in the fifth round, or as I like to call it, the crapshoot of the NFL draft, the Jacksonville Jaguars select. And when I say crapshoot, I'm going to do a little wink, and that's going to be for you, Brett Martineau, because that's what you said. That's what you said.
I like it. Thanks for the nod. You're
welcome.
I would appreciate it.
I can't wait. Yep.
If I can get it. I'm really trying to go find it's always hard for me to do very quickly. Oh, by the way, I want you guys to, while I do this, go to Google and explain what the, you know how Google changes their, like, the page sometimes, depending on the holiday or the whatever. Well, what are they doing on Google today?
It's probably going to be something offensive that you just said.
You know what they didn't do, right?
April Fool's
thing? They were supposed to do a ton of April Fool's stuff, and they didn't.
Dude.
And so they're honoring...
Oh, go ahead. I'm sorry.
Well, so when you click on it, it takes you to... and the problem I have is I'm not going to be able to say her name, so I'm not even going to try. But it was an Australian medical doctor and scientist. So they're, like, honoring...
Yeah, you talk about the girl in crutches?
I'm just talking about the whole scene. Usually I know what it is.
This thing right here?
Yeah.
Yeah, you're talking about Dame Jean McNamara?
McNamara, is that how you say
it? Yeah, talk about Dame Jean McNamara?
I guess so.
Yeah, it's her 121st birthday. Where you been? Step your game up.
So that's what they're doing?
A little respect, yeah. I don't know who she is.
How did you find that so quickly?
Hey, check this out. All you got to do is hold the mouse over it, and it pops up, and it tells you what it is.
I learned something new.
Yeah.
I
mean,
here you go. Best known for her contributions to children's health and welfare.
Okay, so now I get it. But, I mean, I looked at that, and I was like, what is this? Like, what? Usually you can understand what they're all about.
Well, I mean, have you looked at the picture really, though? Because what's going on here?
Yeah, she's...
Yeah,
well,
but
they're looking in the mirror. Yeah. It's going to be very hard for radio here.
Okay, well, okay.
What do you?
It's like the Twilight Zone, though.
A little bit.
Well, they're looking in the mirror, so there's a girl on crutches looking in the mirror, and she doesn't have crutches in the mirror. And then the teacher, it appears, is also looking in the mirror at the girl, and the teacher looking in the mirror doesn't have crutches, but the reflection in the mirror, she has crutches. So what are they saying?
That's what I was asking
she's
you guys.
She's helping them mentally view themselves not as, say...
Ah, cool. Very good.
And she already views herself that way, even though she's actually old and essentially on crutches.
Oh, man.
Cool. That was good.
Did you
have to Google that?
You did.
No, I didn't. I'm looking at it. I'm interpreting it. This
was your interpretation. Were you good at reading comprehension?
I got chills.
But that was good right there. That's what I got out of it. I had no idea either. I looked at it. That's why I brought it up. I was asking you guys. I was like, what is this?
They're also supposed to be both the O's in Google.
What does that mean?
I get that. It's always
that. Well, that just
means
they're spelling out Google like they always do.
Yeah, well, yeah, I get that. But why not make them like, okay, yeah, I got it. Whatever. Sounds good. Wow. Dang.
All right.
Kuz, that's the most impressive thing. I'm sorry that Kuz has ever done on
the
show.
That was good interpretation.
That was great. Nice job, man.
All right. Nice work. We're so off. But here's what I wanted to do. Thanks for buying me the time to find out the Rams.
Are you good now?
Yeah, the Rams and Redskins trade from years ago.
For the RG3 trade.
The Rams got the number 6 and number 39 overall picks in 2012, the number 22 pick in 13, and a first-round pick in 14. Okay, so if you'd want to do the equivalent, and I don't know if some of this has changed, but if you want to do the equivalent, well, that's like the Jags giving up 9 and their second round pick this year, but then you're throwing in Yannick. Mm-hmm. So that's, I mean, Yannick should take care of a first round pick.
The first round pick.
So if you threw
especially
in Yannick.
He's only 25.
I mean, you might only have to give up like a first.
But you got to keep in mind the price of inflation, Brent, possibly.
I don't know where it's gone. I don't know if it is or not. I mean, again, the problem with the Redskins and Yon is I think they're pretty comfortable in their pass rush. They've got Kerrigan, right? And then obviously they have a choice if they want to get Chase Young.
Yeah.
But if they could get
Montez Sweat, too. They drafted last year in the first round.
Too, right.
Yeah.
So that's why the Yon stuff doesn't fit there very well.
But then does the Chase Young fit there, though? Well,
yeah. That's a good point, I guess.
Jack. Hey, go ahead and give Jacksonville a call, Jack Del Rio.
Yeah, that's a good call. I mean, Kerrigan, you got to remember, too, right? Rivera and obviously Del Rio, both defensive guys.
Yeah.
So are they going to pass up getting Chase Young?
I don't think so, man. I think there are a lot of people
that think, though, Redskins could really fast-track their rebuild or like back to relevancy by trading away that number two pick. I mean, the Dolphins have 3 first-round picks. Jags obviously have a couple. I think the Redskins are interesting. And if you threw Yannick in there, I mean, say Yannick is worth a first and a fourth.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that then you don't have to give away next year's first round pick. You give away number nine. You gave Jan. You give a fourth and a second, something like that. Maybe you can, yeah, you might be able to get the value there if you add the player in. But again, that's where I think Trent Williams could come into play on that type of deal.
Yeah.
It's an interesting one. I think it's a very unlikely one, but it's an interesting one. I like that. And by the way, Josh brought that up as like a bold move. And I say, yeah, that is bold. That would be bold, and that would be something. That would get everybody rocking too, I think, here in Jacksonville. For sure. Chase Young and Josh Allen. Although I don't mind Jan and Josh Allen if they could somehow figure that out. More to come, including the, I didn't get to it this segment, Christian Dawkins documentary. Just a brief thought or two on that because I'm assuming not everybody's seen it. 10 questions we'll play and more football after this on ESPN 690.
This is Action Sports Jax on ESPN 690.
Gonna give me some of that going up into.
Kuz,
it's unreal.
That's the most impressive thing Kuz has ever done.
Oh, without a doubt.
On the show.
That was very nice.
It's the best use of Star 690 ever.
Listen weekdays from 3 to 6 p.m. in your car or stream them ESPN690.com.
These days, the whole world is on the internet 24/7, on their phones, at work, even at the dinner table. It's the internet all the time. So why, when it's time to sell your home, does your traditional agent charge you 6% to list it on the MLS to other agents, instead of targeting buyers directly online? That's why Rex was born. For a fee starting at 2%, Rex sells your home where buyers are looking, online, optimized by data-driven marketing, not on the MLS. To get started, visit sellwithrex.com. That's sellwithrex.com. With Rex, selling or buying a home has never been easier. Price your home, get a virtual consultation, visit online open houses and showings, all from the comfort of your home with a few clicks of a button. Want to learn more? Visit sellwithrex.com. Or just use your phone and call 833-REX-HOME. That's 833-739-4663.
J. David Tax Law wants you to know that they are here to help individuals and businesses with tax debt issues during the coronavirus pandemic. Hey, everybody, this is Brent Martineau. Tax problems can be extremely stressful, especially now. If you owe a tax debt, there are new programs available that can help reduce or eliminate your IRS or sales tax burden. These programs expire on July 15th, so don't wait. Get the help you need with tax debt, payroll taxes, bank levies, wage garnishments, tax liens, and unfiled returns. With a $1 trillion economic stimulus package on the way, the IRS will be collecting an unprecedented amount of tax debt to fund this historic initiative. At J. David Tax Law, only highly experienced tax attorneys will represent you. Never trust your tax situation to anyone you can't walk in and look in the eye. If you have federal or state sales tax debt, have a sit down with J. David Tax Law. Your first step is a no-cost consultation. Call J. David Tax Law at 904-507-4777 or go to jdavidtaxlaw.com.
This is a CMG Open for Business report. During these changing times, it's challenging for businesses across North Florida, big and small, but businesses are adjusting to meet your needs in a safe and comfortable way. Here's today's list of businesses that are open for you. Metro Rooter, Beaver Chevrolet, Wolfgang Bakery and Grooming, Den Out PDR, Castelli Chiropractic Center, Comfort Zone. If you're open for business, let us know by emailing us at openjax@cmg.com. Together, we're getting through this.
Hi, I'm attorney Robert Rubenstein with another edition of Rubenstein's Rules for Personal Injury. Rule number 3, insurance companies are not your friends. They are not your good neighbors, and you are definitely not in good hands. Insurance companies fight every day to not pay claims. They don't want you to get a lawyer, but they have lawyers. So what should you do? Hire someone who is really on your side right now. Call Rubenstein Law at 1-800-FL-LEGAL. Offices in Jacksonville and throughout Florida.
Why, did you know that 1-to-1 Financial is the only financial institution in Jacksonville with a fleet of live teller machines? That means you can practice social distancing and still do nearly all of your banking using a drive-through LTM at most 1-to-1 Financial locations. It's like an ATM with FaceTime, so you have the option to connect with a live teller via video feed when you need one. No other credit union or bank offers this in Jacksonville. See what else you're missing at 1-to-1-FCU.org. Federal. Insured by NCUA.
This is a CMG Open for Business report. During these changing times, it's challenging for businesses across North Florida, big and small. But businesses are adjusting to meet your needs in a safe and comfortable way. Here's today's list of businesses that are open for you. Mercedes-Benz of Orange Park, Alano's Coffee, All Florida Custom Homes, Joe's Crab Shack, Cartel's Kitchen Food Truck, Courtyard Oceanfront. If you're open for business, let us know by emailing us at openjax@cmg.com. Together, we're getting through this.
Looking for a different lunch experience? Come dine with us on Fridays at Clara's at the Cathedral, located at 256 East Church from 11 a.m. to 1:30 p.m. Treat yourself weekly to an upscale menu, live entertainment, and fellowship with friends and colleagues you don't want to miss. Call and reserve your seat or table today at 354-4162 or log on to clarawhitemission.org. All proceeds benefit the Clara White Mission.
Get in the zone, AutoZone.
Welcome to AutoZone. What are you working on today? So you ordered some wipers online with our free same-day store pickup? No problem. We'll grab those for you so you can get back on the road. You know, we also offer free next-day delivery. You just order what you need on AutoZone.com by 10 p.m., and we deliver it to your front door the next day. It's perfect for those projects that can wait until tomorrow. Getting your job done just got easier. Free next-day delivery on eligible items on orders over $35. Restrictions and details at AutoZone.com.
Get in the zone, AutoZone.
Getting the job done right means working with a team as dedicated to your business as you are. Introducing the Lowe's for Pros loyalty program, built just for pros. Get personalized offers based on the supplies you use most, track purchases and never miss a beat, and get the tools to manage your business. Why? Because you're the one sweating the details every day, and it's time someone had your back. Enroll today at lowesforpros.com. Do it right for less. Start with Lowe's.
Broadcasting live from the ESPN 690 Anna Jar and Levine Studios. Anna Jar and Levine Accident Attorneys. Call 904-600-4000. That's 904-600-4000. ESPN 690, Jacksonville's home for ESPN Radio.
WOKV Jacksonville. Listen live everywhere you go on ESPN690.com. ESPN 690, a Cox Media Group station.
Brent Martineau.
You see him every day on CBS 47, Fox 30, Action Sports Jax.
Austin Lane.
He's a former Jag star and current MMA fighter.
Broadcasting live from the Anna Jar and Levine Studio.
This is Action Sports Jax on ESPN 690 and ESPN690.com.
Team that comes to my mind is the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Why? Because Tom Brady is there. Why? Because Mike Evans and Chris Godwin and O.J. Howard and Cameron Brayton, those boys with Bruce Arians, are still there. Also, you have to remember, even with Tom Brady arriving, the number one thing we were willing to say is that the NFC South is still the New Orleans Saints to lose. Drew Brees re-upped. They acquired Emmanuel Sanders. They still have Michael Thomas and Alvin Kamara. And you still have Sean Payton. So clearly they're going to be the favorites in the NFC South. And so many times we looked at teams in the NFC South and we said, if they don't win the division, the wild card usually is not going to come out of there.
Well, that was Stephen A. Smith. Apparently, First Take stole Kuz's question yesterday on 10 questions.
It's unbelievable.
Which I actually didn't even think was a good question.
I mean,
Kuz has done a fantastic job. Like, his question about who would your announced team be from Nickelodeon, good. Former Jag, even though you said Mercedes Lewis, that would help the team right away, good.
Yeah.
Like, he's had some really good questions, but if I'm being completely honest, like, I didn't really think that question was one of the best because I think all teams will benefit at some time or another. But obviously, First Take liked the question, Goose, because they stole it. They listened to our show.
Did you see what Big Cat Country posted last night for one of their questions?
No.
If you could name two people from Nickelodeon to announce football games, who would it be?
Well, I will say this. I'm not – maybe Kuz stole that from Big Bad Country.
I didn't. I actually just thought of that one.
I think there's a lot of that going on.
I'm just joking around. I'm not saying anything.
Yeah, that one, that kind of question, I feel like most people could come to that.
That's a fun topic. It's a bad topic for me because I can't even name a Nickelodeon show other than what was it used to be, Double Dare or something like that.
Can you imagine like
Double Dare? Dude, Guts? You remember Guts?
Nah, I wasn't a Guts
guy. The Super Aggro Craig?
No.
Kuz, you remember Guts?
No,
here's the problem. Both of you get out of here.
Here's the problem. I don't remember that one. I was like
Guts,
Angry Beavers,
Mike O'Malley.
Cat Dog. I don't think I was in that one. It might be before I was into TV and stuff.
You just didn't do TV as a kid for a little bit? You went on strike? What'd you do?
I'm telling you, the first ones I remember are like Angry Beavers and Cat Dog.
What about Legends of the Hidden Temple?
I like that.
Okay, so you're down with that.
The Blue Barracudas was my team.
My team, and they never won. It was always the Purple Patriot and the Red Jaguars.
I had a hoodie.
Jealous of that. Number. What about What Would You Do? Probably a little too old or young.
No, was that the one with the head and like the things would pop up? Was that?
No, that was Figure It Out.
Figure It Out. Yeah. That's what I'm thinking of.
Okay.
And All That.
Okay, All That.
I tried out for All That.
I see you. What?
They held tryouts in Philly, and I went.
Really?
Me and my one friend Dan went, yeah.
Didn't go so well?
I mean, I was like seven.
I guess you get them next time. All right. Well, that's been our Nickelodeon talk for the day.
And we're back. Hey, everybody. Welcome back to Sports Jacks on ESPN 690. Brent Martineau, Austin Lane, Coos.
How have you never heard of Guts, though, man?
I think I've heard of it and just never saw it. You asked me if I've seen it.
Whatever. Okay, let's keep on going here. I can only be so offended one day. And right now, I'll be honest with you, I'm getting to my limit, okay? So let's make it through the next 45 minutes or so and some change and not have any more incidents, please.
Good thing for social distancing. I can't get hit today.
You'd be surprised.
Speaking of watching, mm-hmm. I watched on HBO. It was a bad move by me. It was like 12:20, 12:30. We had just finished another episode of Homeland. Season one.
12:30 today or last night?
Last
like in the
morning.
Jeez.
And then so I'm flipping through and I see on HBO.
Go to bed, man.
The Scheme, I think it's called.
Okay.
So it's Christian Dawkins. And Christian Dawkins is at the epicenter of the FBI's involvement with the NCAA and the cheating coaches and the paying players and all this stuff. That's like the very Cliff Notes summary of kind of what was going on. But anyway. He's like front and center in this documentary, and I mean, he had to get paid to do it, but he's sharing his story, and he takes you through the whole thing. Now, he's been sentenced to 18 months in federal prison, but he's appealing it. It's fascinating because it really takes you through, like, that thing was so drawn out. There's so much legalese, and if you go back, again, we didn't have our show during that time, but if you go back to like 15, 16, 17 when a lot of this was going on, in 17 it got really hot. Mm-hmm. And I remember saying back then, and I was a big believer in it, if the FBI is after you, look out. Mm-hmm. They're going to get you.
Yeah.
Well, it looked like the FBI was after the NCAA, and they were going to get them. Well, it turns out they really haven't got them. Like, where has it gone? The story's gone away. We don't see it. Hmm. Well, what they did is they ended up getting Dawkins because Dawkins, in hindsight, now after seeing this, is he wouldn't cooperate.
And so he wouldn't kind cooperate. Of the scapegoat?
Well, he became a guy that battled the FBI on it, went to court on it, and wouldn't give up everything they wanted to. Like, wouldn't knowingly wear a wiretap and go to meet with coaches and all these things. And the thing about it, again, it's really hard if you haven't seen it, but I was watching this last night and it's fascinating because I was like, my whole perspective of this, not really reading deep on it and every article, was that Dawkins was a bad guy in this whole thing. Mm-hmm. Like, he was the guy that helped create all this stuff. Well, in a sense, he might be, depending on how you view it. He was paying players, like, no doubt about it. He was at the epicenter of paying players. But he really was trying to combat the NCAA.
Yeah.
Right? And it depends how you view this big picture. So it really gets back to paying players more than anything.
Yeah.
If you think about the whole topic, it's one like, wow, the FBI never – why didn't they turn all these guys up? What happened to Sean Miller? What happened to the LSU coach? You know, what happened to these guys? Like, you know, obviously Rick Pitino had his thing, but that was more because of the strippers and prostitutes and all that school found.
Yeah, but Dawkins also set up those. Didn't Dawkins set up the meetings with Adidas where, like, you go to Adidas schools?
Louisville he was in Adidas
was
school.
Was obviously yes. in Adidas school.
So what's interesting is it's a fascinating thing because basically in the court systems, they end up arguing that you're scamming and frauding the universities.
Yeah.
It's like, really? It feels like the universities and the programs are frauding the players.
But on the other hand,
and everybody else.
You can almost call them, and I didn't watch the documentary, but by the sounds of it, you can almost call Christian Dawkins like a Robin Hood, right? Where he's helping out these possibly underprivileged kids.
Great point.
Going to these high institution programs that make billions and billions of dollars. And he's trying to make sure that they get their cut as well.
So that's – see, it all depends on your perspective of it.
Yeah.
And that's what was interesting to me. I came off after the documentary, and again, this is probably shaded toward him anyway. I believe he probably got paid for it and all this stuff. And it's his story. It's – nobody else talked. Like, Sean Miller wasn't talking. Coaches weren't talking.
So it's just one perspective.
It's one perspective. But some of it's very factual. I mean, they play the conversations. I mean, Sean Miller – it is the audacity that those guys had to stand up there after all this came out, like as it was coming out, and say, I have never paid a player. I've never had anything to do with it. I don't know anything about it. I mean, that the FBI and this documentary played phone conversations with Dawkins and those guys, Sean Miller and Wade from LSU, like talking about money being handed over. Mm-hmm. But listen, here's the thing. We've always known that. Like, we all have known that. It's a dirty game. I mean, they've been doing it for a long time, paying players. And so it really comes down to how do you believe? What do you believe in?
Sure.
Do you believe the players should be paid? Mm-hmm. And this is just a way to facilitate that because the NCAA is the bad guy and can't and won't allow it?
And in which case, Christian Dawkins comes across as more, I don't want to say a hero, but you know what? He's like an anti-hero where it's like, you see where he's coming from.
You do. And there's a little bit of that here.
And by some people could say
to the kids and families, he is a hero in a lot of senses.
Of course.
And the coaches are really just doing what they should be doing to circumvent the NCAA.
Yeah.
And not only just to win games, but because they should be getting something for their services. Like, I think it was, they said, they named like the top six schools, right? Mm-hmm. Ohio State gets like $250 million from Nike a year. Like, Louisville is a great example in all this because they're really front and center on a lot of it. They get $162 million, I think it was, from Adidas. Mm-hmm. And I think it was Dan Wetzel, who's a journalist, and he was in on it. He's like, if you are getting $162 million from somebody, you work for them.
Yeah.
And you're right. You do.
You know what? It reminds me a lot. Did you ever watch the Fab Five documentary, the 30 for 30?
You know, I feel like I've seen parts of the 30 for 30.
So I'm reminded of a scene where, you know, this is like right when the Fab Five has officially taken off, right? And everyone's rocking the black Nike socks because that, like, they started that thing. Everyone's rocking the baggy shorts now. And I think it was Jalen Rose was with an assistant coach just walking, like, you know, downtown. I think it must have been Ann Arbor, whatever it was. But they're walking downtown, and there's a Nike display. And in the display, it's a Michigan jersey with a Michigan shirt of, you know, the Fab Five and everything.
Yes.
And then they're rocking the socks and the shoes and everything.
That.
And Jalen Rose is like, hey, that's us, right? And the guy's like, yeah, that's you guys. And he's like, why aren't we making any money for that? Like, that's a display. Like, they're selling our names. They're selling our style. We started it, and we're not seeing a penny of that. You know, like, they can put that in their storefront windows, but I'm going home every single night, and I'm still eating, like, ramen noodles. So, like, that was an interesting perspective, you know? And the problem is, Brent, that not everybody can relate to that, right? Because to come from, you know, low means and to come from a bad place, of course you're going to hope that people can get, you know, paychecks from college and things like that. But it's hard for, you know, the people that maybe grew up a little better than other kids did to come down and say, well, yeah, everyone should get paid. It's hard to come along with that. But when you have examples like that with the Jalen Rose story, when you have examples like Christian Dawkins, who, listen, I didn't watch the documentary. I don't know what type of guy he is, but I honestly think, his heart might have been a good place to try to help these, you know, underprivileged athletes out. Now, of course, what he did was illegal, and you have to suffer the consequences. That's what you sign up for, but you're still trying to help the, you know, the underprivileged.
Yeah.
And I think that's the biggest thing we had to remember.
And I don't know if Dawkins is like a good guy in all this. I think he's spinning it toward, but his thought process makes sense. He's still trying to cash in, and the bottom line is he probably shouldn't have gone to jail, but the FBI was like, hey, I'm getting somebody out of this, and you're the guy we're getting because you didn't cooperate. If you want to cooperate, that's the moral of the story. If the FBI ever asks you to cooperate, you may want to cooperate because you're going down. If not, they will find a way to make it go down, at least from this angle of it. And it's believable, too, because they talk about that court in New York, and it's like 97% conviction rate, you know, if the FBI gets involved. So they will get something on you, you know. But I mean, they really only got him for 18 months, and I guess, like, when they had the whole list, the whole rap sheet, could have got like 200 years in prison. So they didn't get him for as much as one would think. But it's really fascinating. See, and from my seat, if I'm being completely honest, I thought this would help clean up college basketball, the investigation. I looked forward to that, shuffling it up, right? Shuffle the deck up. ruffle the feathers. It would be bad for basketball for a few years, probably. It would set them back. But in the long run,
eventually, yeah,
it would be better for what it's intended to be. This whole thing of student athlete, this whole thing of amateurism. Well, you know, you watch that a little bit, and then you read up a little bit more on the story, and it's the NCAA has it so wrong. But I don't think I've been that wrong on it all along. I've always said the problem with the NCAA is they are afraid to admit they're big business. They still operate under a nonprofit umbrella, even though they make $1 billion in March off March Madness in college basketball TV rights. So it's big business. So is college football. It's big business. And so with all this pay-to-play stuff going on, I've always said the sooner you will admit that it's big business and it's not student-athlete, then players will get paid. I'm still not sure the best way to do that. Do you make it the Wild Wild West? Do you make it capitalism at its best where, hey, if Zion Williamson's worth $200,000 to a shoe company, he can be a freshman at Duke and make $200,000.
Sure.
I mean, again, their example in there is not wrong. I think Wetzel said it. It's like if you have this unbelievable smart kid at Michigan or Harvard or whatever, you can give that kid an internship if you're Google for $25,000 in the summer and say, yeah, but we want you to work for us when you graduate. You can do that. But why can't you do it in college basketball? I don't know if there's a good answer to say, I don't know why you can't do that in college basketball.
And I'm always going to make the point of why can a student go to a school for a scholarship in band? Like, let's say they play the saxophone. Why can a student go to college for band? They can turn around and offer private lessons and charge people to learn how to play the saxophone. But an NFL or a college football player can't have a football camp where they can generate some revenue, or they can't even go on YouTube and try to make some profit. To me, it's not fair.
No, it's really not. It's not aligned. And
but, I mean, you hit it right on the head. Until the NCAA can come out and admit that it's big business, then we're going to keep on just going around in circles. I mean, it comes down to the NCAA admitting it.
Yeah, and so there's another part of this that I don't know how I feel about, okay? And again, you're going to have to watch a bit of it and see what you think. And this isn't like Tiger King. I get it. Not everybody's watched it. But I've watched this and not Tiger King. So, and I just think it's a really interesting look at what we have done as a sports fan and society for a long time is turned our cheek. We know they cheat in college football. We know they cheat in college basketball and probably more sports too, but we're okay with it because we like our college football.
We don't care.
We like our March Madness in our bracket.
Yeah.
And so we're okay with it. And see, so I've always said, I really think it's the most egotistical profession you can find is college football coaches and college basketball coaches. I think it's all about them. It's not about the student athlete. It's about them. It's about them winning games, getting shoe contracts, making millions. And that's a blanket statement. That's not the, listen, I think Matthew Driscoll and Tony Jacek, I think it's way more than that.
Oh, without a doubt.
So it's not across the board, but that's my view on a blanket outlook, especially of these big schools. It's about them. But it makes you think twice is if they've made it about them and they've done it this way and they've cheated a little bit, because cheating sounds so dirty, but they've cheated because it's really the NCAA that has got it backwards. You know, we've been trained, and all my life, 42 years old, I don't think I'd ever really thought about it that way until maybe the last couple of years when all this pay to play and has come up, and now even things like this documentary. So it really makes you look at it from the other side, and not defend kind of that governing body of the NCAA, which few people do defend the governing body of the NCAA. Anyway. But I kind of have always thought, well, the Sean Millers of the world and even Rick Pitino, who I loved when I was 9 years old and brought the Friars to the 1987 Final Four, those guys are dirty, man. I mean, they're dirty. Like, I don't like – I have not a ton of respect for those kind of guys. Mm-hmm. You got to even have second thoughts about that. Should they – maybe this is just kind of the way they have to operate to really give some of these kids the best chance – to not only get somewhat of a college education, but also make it to their dream, the NBA, especially with the NBA rules coming out of high school.
You know what, man? At the end of the day, it's just the power of sports, and it's the power of collegiate sports, because like you said, the NCAA may be in the wrong, but there's always ways that coaches use to their advantage to try to, I don't want to say necessarily cheat, but they kind of fudge the rules a little bit, right? Like, think about this. If you're a basic high school student, you have to maintain a certain GPA. You have to be, you know, like a valedictorian to go to Harvard, things like that. Like, you have to have all these accolades in order to even get a next education, right? But if you're good at throwing a football, if you're good at running a football, if you're good at tackling somebody, well, then you can turn around and say, well, you know what? I want to go to college here. Oh, man, you know what? My GPA, it's not high enough. The coach can be like, well, you know what? You're a really good football player. Let's go ahead and I'm going to make a couple phone calls. I'm going to talk to the president. Let's see if I can get you in. And 9 times out of 10, if you're good enough, they'll get you in the university, man. All right? Yeah. That's the way it works.
They'll find
that's
a way.
That's an example of, you know, not really going behind the NCAA's back per se, but you're essentially going against the rules that the university has set, and you're kind of circumnavigating those rules. And that's what it's come down to now in the NCAA. You know, that's just one example, but every coach does it, Brent. You know, and like, did I see cheating firsthand at Murray State? No, not really, because you know why? No one's giving me money underneath the table because we're Murray State and we're a basketball school. So let's be, I mean, we're a football school now. Quincy Williams, what's up? But you know, but we've been a basketball school. So I haven't seen it firsthand, but you know it's all around. And like you said, I think the first step is the NCAA coming out and admitting that it is big business. And once you do that, then I think the dominoes fall where they may, and then these things can come to light a little more, and then you can kind of reset the set of rules here so it benefits everybody.
Yeah, it makes you think about how deep it is when Creighton is involved.
Yeah.
Creighton paying players $100,000. You know? I mean, according to these things. You know, it's like, well, and you know, Creighton's pretty good, but and Creighton used to be kind of like a little bit of the little Butler and Gonzaga-esque, you know,
once in a while. Kinda,
but now Creighton, well, this year, what are they, like a top 10 team, like a number 2 seed type of team?
They've been very consistent.
It just shows you that they do it. And again, it's hard for me to escape. Like, the one part about it, if you watch this thing, it's like, how does Wade at LSU and Sean Miller, how did they get out of this thing? Well, sounds like maybe the right people got in touch with the right people.
Yeah.
I mean, if you really believe
well,
in that
there's
stuff.
That, and then
I
also,
mean, it's got a little mafia mentality between not only the coaching circle, but also the NCAA to say, wait, we don't want all this. Let's get the FBI go away.
Yeah.
And so that will be some documentary down the road at how it all got squashed and who lets the secrets out there. Fascinating, man. It really was. So I invite you to go watch. Everybody's talking about Tiger King, but if you go see Scheme.
I'm about to check it out.
It was pretty wild.
You said it's on HBO.
This was an HBO thing, and it's floating around there now. But
cool.
And again, it's very Dawkins, his story side of it, but it's a fascinating one.
Interesting.
And really shed some light on it. So I thought that was pretty wild thing. And also the reason I brought it up, too, is because it's just like a story. They are right about this. It's gone away. Like, it has gone away. Like, where did it go? I thought the NCAA, I thought March Madness, I thought college basketball was in deep, deep trouble.
Yeah. We're seriously only a year removed from it. You know? We're literally only 1 year removed and gone.
It's gone. Oof. Like, nobody talks about it. There's no end game. Like, there was no, hey, coming out in 2 months.
Yeah.
It was Christian Dawkins, and that was about it.
Mm-hmm.
Wild stuff.
Well, it just goes to show you the power of the scapegoat, right? Like, if you have somebody to point the finger at and say, it was this guy, he initiated everything. Sometimes people can forget then.
Skeletons
call it the Tom Coughlin effect.
Buried.
Yeah.
In the NCAA.
Yeah.
No doubt about it. Mm-hmm. Nothing is changing, I don't think.
Yeah.
Absolutely wild. All right, when we come back, we play 10 questions. We get back to a little football stuff, and we put a bow on a show Wednesday here on Action Sports Jacks on ESPN 690.
Action Sports Jax with Brent Martineau on ESPN 690 is brought to you by Best Bet Jacksonville and Orange Park.
Now, the first alert forecast on ESPN 690.
Clear and quite cool tonight. Sweaters and jackets as temperatures drop into the 40s. From the First Alert Weather Center, I'm Action News Jax, Chief Meteorologist Mike Burrish.
Hey boss, have you heard about SafeTouch? They're now offering a free health and wellness package with every SafeTouch system.
Health and wellness package? Actually, that sounds kind of nice.
Yeah, well, not for us crooks. You know the SafeTouch two-way communicator?
Of course I know the SafeTouch two-way communicator.
Yeah, so we already know that it's the best deterrent against, you know, crooks like us, but it can also be like a 911 dispatcher for other emergencies.
Like medical emergencies.
Yeah, there's the two-way communicator, the emergency buttons, the smartphone app. It's all just extra peace of mind for SafeTouch customers.
Great. As if people need another reason to get SafeTouch.
Well, the good news is it's not going to change our Crooks or Us motto.
Stay away from SafeTouch houses.
Some things never change.
Crooks know to stay away from SafeTouch houses. Hi, I'm Lester Jackson, president of SafeTouch Security Systems. No one beats our technology or our price.
Call SafeTouch today at 888-723-8682 or go to safetouch.com. State license number EF233.
Buy online from the comfort of your home when you shop ArlingtonToyota.com. At Arlington, they get it. They know right now things are different. But instead of thinking of things we can't do, Arlington is focused on what we can do, like shopping online from home at ArlingtonToyota.com. Getting your ride delivered to your door. Even the parts department will deliver parts to your door. And service? Drop it off and they'll give you a free ride home. I knew I always liked Arlington Toyota. Plus, you can still get savings up to 50% less on the ride you've been wanting. And it's all at ArlingtonToyota.com, like a 2020 Toyota Corolla. It's not $17,635. Now it's only $14,991. That's $14,991 for a pre-owned 2020 Toyota Corolla at Arlington. How about a 2019 Toyota RAV4? It's not $24,195. Now it's $19,471. Yeah, just $19,471 for a pre-owned 2019 Toyota RAV4 at Arlington. For shopping with all the comforts of home, visit ArlingtonToyota.com. Visit ArlingtonToyota.com/50% off for offer details.
At times like this, it's easy to realize just how much we take some things for granted. The produce person or cashier at your local grocery store, the teller at the drive-thru of your bank or credit union, or the chef or server at your favorite restaurant. Right now, lots of small businesses in our area are doing what they can, just like you, to hang in there. Some are working to serve their clients in creative new ways, while working on keeping their employees and customers safe. And some will even close their doors for the time being, out of concern for the greater good. Do your neighbors and local business community this favor. Log on. Connect with your favorite stores and providers online. Give them a shout on Facebook or Instagram and show your support. And when we get back to normal, they'll be happy to serve you and show you that you have never been taken for granted. This message brought to you by Cox Media Group and your friends at Forever Vets Animal Hospital, Safe Touch Security, and Beard's Diamonds.
This is Pastor Abraham Lincoln Washington, and it's time for the truth. Do you want a happy family and a happy home? Well, who knew we'd be spending this much time at home? But if you want it to be a happy place, remember this truth. The family that prays together stays together. You can make your house happy with prayer.
This has been Pastor Abraham Lincoln Washington, and the truth will make you free.
Let's say you have ED, male impotence. Or maybe you suffer from PE and can't satisfy your partner. If you have either or both of these embarrassing conditions, Prime Men's Medical Center has the solution. Meet Dr. Rubinsky, a specialist in men's health.
If you're experiencing ED or PE, Prime Men's Medical Center has custom blended medications designed just for you. There's no pain and no surgery. If you have diabetes, high blood pressure, or prostate issues, not a problem. If Viagra, Cialis, or Levitra have let you down, Prime Men's Medical Center has patients lasting 30, 60, 90 minutes or longer. You'll see results on your first visit guaranteed, or your visit is free. And best of all, it's affordable.
For a private consultation with our highly skilled physicians, call 904-206-8105. We guarantee that you'll see results on your first visit, or there's no charge for your consult. Call Prime Men's Medical Center now at 904-206-8105. That's 904-206-8105.
These days, the whole world is on the internet 24/7, on their phones, at work, even at the dinner table. It's the internet all the time. So why, when it's time to sell your home, does your traditional agent charge you 6% to list it on the MLS to other agents, instead of targeting buyers directly online? That's why Rex was born. For a fee starting at 2%, Rex sells your home where buyers are looking, online, optimized by data-driven marketing. not on the MLS. To get started, visit sellwithrex.com. That's sellwithrex.com. With Rex, selling or buying a home has never been easier. Price your home, get a virtual consultation, visit online open houses and showings, all from the comfort of your home with a few clicks of a button. Want to learn more? Visit sellwithrex.com. Or just use your phone and call 833-REX-HOME. That's 833-739-4663.
The United States is among the most dangerous developed nations in which to give birth. It's not fine, but together we can do something about it. Help March of Dimes give every mom and baby the best possible start. Sign up today and join us at March for Babies to walk alongside thousands of supporters to raise awareness and funds to fight for the health of all moms and babies. Register now at marchforbabies.org.
Hey, boss, check out this headline. Safe Touch Security. Your health and safety are all we do.
Safe Touch again? Is that all you ever talk about?
Boss, your mom still has a Safe Touch security system, right?
That is correct. Don't make any comments.
No, I can't blame you. Having a Safe Touch system is like having a halo of protection surrounding her.
Exactly. For instance, let's say, God forbid, that she needed the fire department.
Not to worry, Safe Touch can respond.
Or let's say she stubbed her toe, the mother of all toe stubs, and she couldn't get to the phone.
Safe Touch can contact emergency toe fixes.
I never thought I'd say this, but I'm glad Safe Touch is out there.
Boss!
I know, but that doesn't mean we don't stick to the Crooks of Us motto. Stay away from Safe Touch houses.
Crooks know to stay away from Safe Touch houses. Hi, I'm Lester Jackson, president of Safe Touch Security Systems. No one beats our technology or our price.
Call Safe Touch today at 888-723-8682 or go to safetouch.com. State license number EF233.
Hey, what's up, everybody? It's Austin Lane from Action Sports Jax on ESPN 690. Smart speakers are becoming part of everyday life, so why not use it to listen to the radio? Tell Alexa, Google Home, or any other speaker to play ESPN 690. Give it a shot weekday afternoons from 3 to 6.
Brent Martineau.
You see him every day on CBS 47, Fox 30, Action Sports Jack.
Austin Lane.
He's a former Jag star and current MMA fighter.
Broadcasting live from the Anajar and Levine studio.
This is Action Sports Jax on ESPN 690 and ESPN690.com.
I got to tell you a story about Peyton, too, because Peyton would try to get you after you have these things with Peyton. And once you get over to the Pro Bowl, you're on the same team. Peyton tried to get you drunk and then try to dig into your brain. What did you see? You know, what did you do this and that? But he tried to, it's on me. Try to feed you all these Mai Tais. You know, he wanted to sit there and keep feeding you all those. And then he wanted to come and ask you and butter you up and ask you, you know, what you see and this and that. I was like, Peyton, I ain't falling for that. You know what I mean? I tell him right there.
That's Ty Law, former Patriot and Hall of Famer now, or will be, right? I think he's either in or got in. I think he's this year's class. I covered Ty Law back in my early days when I was covering the Patriots in Providence. Always a good dude. One of my rare run-ins in a locker room. Not happened with Ty Law, but his secondary mate, Lawyer Malloy.
Oh, yeah, I remember him.
I was like 22 at the time.
Okay.
And Malloy, I just forget about the context now. I don't know what it was, but maybe I asked a stupid question. It wasn't like an antagonistic question. He must have just been in a bad mood.
Wasn't in a good mood. Yeah,
but
it happens.
He was an ass that day. But I was like, yeah, he kind of dressed me down for whatever question I had asked. I was like, oh.
What do you mean dress you down? Like he lit in you a little bit?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, he was just a jerk.
Yeah.
In that situation, because I don't really think I hadn't earned it. Like, it's not like I said something.
Sure.
Like now, if I see you could argue that I earned it.
Yeah,
you know?
Of course,
I mean,
man.
But it's
Cash Money Martineau in the house.
But when
show
I was like 22,
kiss
he had
ring.
No idea who I was.
I got you.
I mean, I'd probably been in the locker room like three times.
Yeah.
Then there was another one. I can't remember who the name. One of my, I haven't had a ton of these really. Like. Just hasn't happened. I thought it would. When it happened at 22 years old with like Malloy, I was like, oh, I'm in for a whole career of this.
Yeah.
You know?
Well,
I mean, that's just the way it is.
Well, that's because you didn't spend a lot of time in my lockers. So that's why it never happened.
That's like a huge fear of mine is just getting absolutely destroyed by like an NBA player
See,
or something like that.
That's I don't know how I'd react to that. Because well, I think like eventually it's going to happen to me, and I'm not going to be the guy that's going to be like, you know, not say anything. I'm
okay,
like,
cool. Oh, yeah? Thanks for your interview. Something?
Let's go. Let's go outside then. Like, that's, I don't want to do that.
Well,
but
I actually, you know what? I always say this now. It's one of my favorite parts of covering Jalen Ramsey because he, you never knew it was about to come, if it was about to happen.
Yeah.
Keeps and on your and toes. It never did, really, like with Ramsey in that sense, like a, you know, shouting match or like, you know, really bounce back at you. He might roll his eyes or be Jalen, but he always made you ready for it. Like, I was never more ready for it than with Jalen, because you start thinking like, okay, don't be a fool here. I don't want to be on ESPN all over the place. And
sure.
And to be honest with you, I've never thought like it was my place or anything to bounce back at a guy. It's in their locker room. If they have the same, you know, I think you want to take the higher road. That would be my way.
Well, I'm
going to
say props to you for thinking like that, because not every media member thinks like
well,
that.
Well, I would, and that's okay if you don't. I just think there's a time and place for a lot of that, and I've just never been, I don't want to be a scene. I don't want to be the guy in the middle of the scene.
No, you just want to do your job,
really,
man, and get in, get out.
So, so anyway, I thought it would happen more. You know what the weirdest one was? And I still, it was so bizarre.
Story time, I can't wait.
Man, it's happened probably 3 or 4 times, but very rarely.
Is this in Jacksonville?
No.
Oh, okay. I was guess
this
who it was.
I was in Albany, okay? This is still very strange to me. And the NBA was playing an exhibition game in Albany. So it was the Celtics versus someone else. Well, first of all, we don't really cover the NBA in Albany, New York, right? But we're covering this. And the way the NBA does it is they have locker room availability prior to the game, much like Major League Baseball. They have it before the game, too, and after.
It's always interesting.
Yeah, it's different. But so we were in there just getting some sound for, hey, the Celtics are here tonight, you know, one of those deals. And honestly, I still, now I don't know who it is. You'd think I would have remembered.
Yeah.
Because I interview one of, you know, at that team, I think I had Pierce on it.
Yeah.
And whoever else at the time. So it had some decent names. But I mean, it might have been like Walter McCarty.
Okay.
You know, I don't even know. But it was somebody, like a forward, a big man.
Yep.
And I was just asking like these stupid generic questions like, hey, what's it be like to play in Albany here? Yeah. You know,
because you don't know who half these guys are. Like, you know, if you ride the bench, you're not going to be in depth at who they are.
Well, that's exactly what the guy comes back. He's like, do you even know who I am? And at the time, like, I did, though. Like, I did. I knew who it was. But I can't even remember who it was, like, now.
Good for you, though.
And so I'm like, oh, yeah, you know, but... And he was a jackass like that day, whoever this guy was now. I should really remember it.
Yeah.
But that was one of the times where I was like, what the heck, man?
Yeah.
I mean, that was like, you're talking about as soft as a scene as you can get.
Yeah, yeah.
Exhibition, NBA game in Albany, New York.
Yeah, yeah.
Before a game that doesn't matter.
Yeah.
This isn't like controversial stuff here.
Yeah.
And I was just so taken aback by the fact that he like clapped back at me like that. It was still the one that was probably the most jarring to me because I just didn't expect it at all.
Yeah.
And now, like, when you do the radio show and stuff, you never know when the guys are listening, or if you're on TV, you never know, and especially in this market.
Mm-hmm.
So you're almost ready for it whenever. You're almost like, well, they might listen, man. You can say what you think, and you're entitled to your opinion, but you might ruffle some feathers. I mean, obviously, Leonard didn't like what Mark had to say last Friday.
Yeah.
And... You know, we've had those situations. I mean, we had one or two in Jacksonville.
Yeah, and listen, it's like I always say, like, I handle, you know, the radio talk like, if I'm going to say something about a player, I expect them to be in the parking lot waiting for me. And whether it's, you know, I say something nice, something bad, I'll have to answer for it. So I always try to think of that from that standpoint. But it's funny that you bring that up, though, about, like, not knowing where somebody is, because I remember being at the Senior Bowl back in 2010. And, you know, the Senior Bowl, I mean, there's tons of players there from different schools. I remember, like, getting interviewed a couple times, and keep in mind, I was a late addition. But I remember, you know, the whole day of the media where they can come talk to you. Like, I participated in now as part of the media. But I remember media coming up to me, and they're just like, hey, so what was Murray State like? You know, like, how was your senior year? Are you excited for the Senior Bowl? Are you excited to get drafted? what do you want to play for? And I remember thinking, like, dude, these, like... Did you guys do any research whatsoever? Like, these are the most generic questions of all time. Like, this is a waste of my time, and I'm answering the same ones over and over again. Well, now fast forward to, you know, last year, my first Senior Bowl in Mobile, Alabama as a media member. Dude, I got my cell phone out. I got notes in my hand. I'm like, it's a stressful environment because you got guys that you obviously want to interview, like you've done some research on, but then there's some other guys that are just free that you can go talk to. So it's crazy, man, just how that whole, you know, how I guess I have a newfound respect for what the media people do, because it is not an easy gig, especially guys that you may not have heard before.
Senior Bowl is an interesting one, right? Because you're not familiar with all these college guys. I mean, you might be some, but not all. And there's 100 and whatever of them.
Yeah.
And you really, like, when we've gone there the last couple of years at that media day, you're like you're looking on your phone and you're like, okay, that's definitely a picture of him.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
You want to make sure because they don't have like cards around their table unless they're at the podium.
Well, then half of them are rocking their like their name tags either, like they're on their credentials, like no one's rocking that, so you have no idea who they are.
And football's the hardest because of the helmet.
Exactly.
Right. So football. So, but you're right, man. Sometimes you do. Sometimes you get thrown in a spot where you really don't know much about the guy, or sometimes it's in golf, you know. Yeah. Like, you go out to, if you cover the Players Championship, like you know some of the big names. Heck, I know golf. I think I know golf pretty well. But you might go out on a Sunday, say, and run into somebody at the range. Well, you don't know who you're going to run into. You don't have time to do homework on the guy.
Well, then what are you going to ask him? Like, hey, so tell us about that shot at number 12. Like, you can only follow so many golfers, man. So I agree with that.
So it's an interesting deal when you have to hide it. But I'll never forget that one, the Celtics guy. Again, I don't know who it was. I really don't. I don't even remember. It wasn't like this huge. It wasn't like Paul Pierce did it.
Yeah.
You know, and I didn't know who Paul Pierce was. It wasn't that. It was like the 10th guy on the roster.
Yeah.
And he was having a bad day, obviously.
So it's funny, man, because, you know, obviously, like, when you have fights coming up, sometimes you do interviews and everything, and like, you can tell, but like, usually the very first question that any interviewer is going to ask you if you have a fight coming up, how is fight camp? You know, I feel fight camp. Has there ever been a fighter in the history of combat sports that said, you know what, this has been the crappiest training camp of all time? I'm probably going to get my ass kicked because we're not really training hard. No, of course, it's going to be, training camp's going well and everything. You know, we're really honed in right now. I'm ready to roll. Like, it's such a useless question, but you use it because maybe you didn't do your homework a lot.
Well, sometimes you have to settle into an interview.
Yeah, true.
I always found that, especially if you're going to ask people, but like, I don't know if I want to come at you with, you know, right away the thing I really want to hit you with.
Yeah.
You know?
You have to throw some softballs first.
Yeah, or just other topics, depending on how serious that one topic is.
Sure.
It was different with a guy, like, I tell you, man, Jalen will always be a fascinating one to me. Different with Jalen, because you didn't know for how long the interview was going to last. So you better get him in.
Yeah, for sure. For sure.
Pretty quick. Yep. But anyway, that's a little communications 101, I guess. I don't know. Ty Law brought me on to Lawyer Malloy. It's brought us on to this somehow.
We're all good, man.
How about 10 questions? You got 10? That maybe first take will steal?
Close enough to 10.
we got 10 in 10 minutes. Let's do it.
Well, with that audio was Ty Law talking about how Peyton would get new players drunk to try to get, you know, defensive schemes and stuff out of them. My question to you is, have you ever seen something like that happen? Austin, that's the first one.
Oh, man. Has there? Oh.
Like a story time.
Yeah, story time. Once again, wish I would have knew about it in advance so I can recollect a little bit. Oh, man, as far as like anything that the cheating, I mean, obviously you have the cases where, you know what, I'm going to share this one. And it's not nothing out of the ordinary, but it's the one that comes to mind. I might have shared it before a little bit, and it's sad because I can't remember this dude's name. But he was an offensive tackle.
Well, that will help. He won't get offended.
That's a good point.
He was an offensive tackle, came from the Saints, and he was actually our NFLPA representative too. Sad I don't know his name. But anyways, we were playing the Saints, and this guy came from the Saints. And literally, he comes in our defensive line meeting room, and he goes through like a power, like Joe Cullen made him go through a PowerPoint presentation about every single call that like the quarterback would, you know, call out, and like every single like formation and audible. It was like a 30-minute thing. And all I could think of was like, Joe Cullen must have had this guy like at gunpoint saying, you're going to do this for me or your ass is gone. So like, we had to do that. And another one I just remembered too. This one is even more crazy. And guess what? It's Peyton Manning involved as well. So Peyton Manning was an Achilles heel for the Jacksonville Jaguars for a long time. Mel Tucker, a pretty genius defensive-minded coach. For whatever reason, we never had success against Peyton Manning. I'll never forget, we're at home getting ready to play the Colts, and Coach Tuck, this goes to show you how crazy coaches can be sometimes. He took every verbiage, every word that Peyton Manning would use in an audible, which, by the way, spoiler, it's Peyton Manning, so it's like tens of hundreds, it seems like. He would play every one of Peyton Manning's audibles and say, all right, here's what he's doing here. Here's what he's doing. Omaha, here's what he's doing here. Red 7, here's what he's doing here. And we went, like, that was our defensive meeting. And not like, all right, so we have to go out there, we got to run this formation, we got to do this stunt. No, it was sit down and let's go through every one of Peyton Manning's audibles. Audible calls. And guess what? Didn't even matter. didn't even scratch the surface. Like, didn't even matter. So, yeah, there you go.
That is wild. Yeah, man. The fact that it didn't even matter.
But, it, the way Coach Tuck came in, though, it was like, I know something nobody else knows. Like, yeah. Check this out. Like, we're about to change the game of football forever. I present you Peyton Manning's audible calls. And it's like, we took it in. I was like, okay, we'll see what happens. There you go.
Go back and find the score of that one.
Exactly. Yeah, wasn't pretty, I don't think.
All right, Brent, do you like the concept of teams playing in bubble cities?
Be more specific.
For the, like, so the NBA, they were talking about, you know, playing in a city.
Where it's safer.
Everyone plays there, essentially, and it's kind of in a spot. And I guess it would be more for TV, yeah, and obviously empty stadium.
Yeah, I thought that's what you meant. That's an interesting concept. I don't – listen, if here's where I thought about this whole thing. It's going to be all or nothing. I don't think we're getting to that point. I don't think we're going to get to the point where you're going to put NBA players and all the other personnel that need to exist in an arena and not get the fans in there. I just don't see it. Now, will the fans be a little reluctant to come back when they do come back because they're still a little uncertain? And that might be the case, so they might be a little bit less crowds. I don't think we're getting to that bubble city kind of mentality. I think the only neutral site thing we could get to is if Major League Baseball has to play playoffs very deep into it, and they can't do it in cold weather cities in November and December. I don't mind the alternative plan, Kuz, because that's a question. I just don't see it happening. I think it's all or nothing. We either can gather now in big crowds and we're all back in it together, or we're all isolated for as long as this ends up being. It's not one toe in and one toe out, 1 foot in, 1 foot out.
All right, fair enough. Austin, since today is April Fool's Day, I figured I'd ask, were there any crazy April Fool's Day pranks that went on in the Jags locker room?
As far as in the Jags locker room, I've shared the story when I got to get my eyebrows shaved and I got tied to the goalpost, poured baby powder all over me. And
that was a little more hazing than April Fool's,
yeah,
right?
Brent didn't do anything. I do have one April Fool's thing, but it's not even an April Fool's thing. It's more of just a prank that I pulled, but it's not football related.
Go ahead. Care. Go for it anyway.
Have I told the deer story before, the deer and the exploding stomach?
I don't think so.
Okay. So in the good old Midwest for homecoming, you know, we have homecoming week. And what that involves is students that are in high school, their parents let them go out a little extra late. You wear all black, and what you want to do is you want toilet paper. You want TP houses. I'm not sure if that's really big in Jacksonville or not, but you know what TPing houses is, Brent? Toilet paper, yep, and throw them in the trees. Kuz, you familiar,
yeah,
with that?
Yeah, but if we did that right now, yeah, people would
say,
panic.
Don't do it right now.
Well, yeah, don't do it right now. Yeah, that's
a hot commodity.
That's like throwing gold down the toilet. But anyways, so my senior year, we want to take it up a notch. So around 9 o'clock, I wear all black. I say bye to my mom. She's like, don't get arrested. I'm like, we'll see what happens. And I go out the door. I get picked up in my friend's Ford pickup truck. There's about six of us in there. We're, you know, packed in like sardines. And my friend who's driving goes, I got something different for us tonight, boys. I'm like, not the usual toilet paper? And he's like, no, I got something different. So we go about a mile down the road to Krause Publications, which is like a printing company right across from where I used to grow up, and there's a dead deer in the road. We take it upon ourselves that we're going to grab the dead deer, put it in the back of the truck, and we're going to pull a prank where we toilet paper a house and then put the dead deer right on the front step, because then the people would open the step, see the dead deer, and obviously the smell, the aroma, it would cause people to panic, right? So We go to our friend's, well, it's not even a, I mean, an acquaintance's house that we're going to, target. It's a really nice house. The girl's name was Kim Kettleson. Shout out to Kim Kettleson, by the way. The setup was we had to drag the dead deer about 200 yards through the woods because we had to sneak up on the house, obviously. We couldn't get caught, especially there because there's lights everywhere. So we had to be real stealthy, a real spy-taking operation. So we start dragging the dead deer. I'm in the front. My friend Moss is right next to me, and two guys are bringing up the rear. As we're dragging the dead deer, I start to hear the sound of a balloon, like, deflating. And I'm like, that's weird. What is that? It's just like a shh. I'm like, what? Does someone have, like, a radio on? Like, what is that? And we're in the woods, so, like, what is going on? So we keep dragging the dead deer a little more. Shh. I'm like, all right, dude, like, what's going on? And, like, if you ever seen The Sandlot, I was like, Squints, like, what is that noise? You know, that's what I said. So I was like, what is that noise? Well, we realize it's coming from the deer. And, you know, being a dumb high schooler at the time, instead of walking away from the incident, I'm like, well, I got to investigate what's going on with this deer right here. So it starts going, and I keep getting my head closer and closer to the sound, and it's coming from the stomach. I'm like, why is it making that sound? Well, in case you didn't know, if something's been killed sometimes, the stomach will inflate until it ruptures and blows up everywhere. Right when I put my head down with my friend Andrew, the stomach explodes. Stomach explodes, I get, I guess they call it bile. I get bile in my mouth, in my eyes. I'm covered in deer guts, so is my friend. And now it comes to the standpoint of, what do we do? Because we can't go back in the truck because we're covered in guts and we smell way too bad. So what do? Obviously, we got to pull forward. We have to move on. It is what it is. We got to finish the mission at hand. So I'm dragging the dead deer still, gagging, almost throwing up to the point because we smell so bad, and we get the dead deer to the door. We run, and it is what it is after that, man. Needless to say, didn't pay attention to biology, I guess, because I didn't know dead deer could do that.
I wouldn't have known that. Has Kim ever heard the story?
Oh, no. Well, I also should mention that later on in that night, we went back and I climbed on top of their roof and I put a bird feeder in their satellite dish. Needless to say, my mom gave me a call a couple days later, said, did you put a bird feeder in Kim Kettleson's satellite dish? I go, I don't know. She goes, Austin? I'm like, yes, I did. She's like, go over there and get it out. So yeah, we ended up getting busted and I had to move everything again.
All right, you go, man.
But yeah, sorry, that was a little long of a story.
The dead
deer
explosion story.
Dude, believe me when I say the smell, and like I said, it got in my mouth, okay? And the taste, like, we're like, imagine just a couple skinny high school kids puking and like gagging and just trying to get up to the doorstep to drop this dead deer off.
I like how you followed through on the.
We had to go through it, man. We had to go through it.
If that were me, we're over. I'm going home and I'm showering.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yep. Find me a lake.
And I think I rode in the back of the pickup truck. Then we took turns. Like three people rode in the back of the pickup truck, got dropped off, and three more guys had to hop in the back because we're not going to ride in and mess up the upholstery, obviously.
All right, Brent, your question. Lamar Jackson and Hollywood Brown were apparently training with Antonio Brown. So do you think there's a chance he goes to the Ravens?
Nah, the Browns.
I think there are a lot of players that respect Antonio Brown and like Antonio Brown. And I think also they're concerned for Antonio Brown. How they feel about him, I think, will be totally different than the risk a team is willing to take. And you have to have really good insulation and be really strong, I think, to go get Antonio Brown. You know, Bruce Arians came out last week, whatever, said, hey, it's just not a fit in our locker room. He didn't pull any punches with it. Could John Harbaugh say, hey, we think we can do this? They've had some personalities in there before now. Mm-hmm. And they've got a strong culture already built. They add to it with a guy like Calais Campbell. That might be a landing spot, potentially. You could kick the tires on it. If you're going to pick maybe two or three teams that might be interested in an Antonio Brown experiment in 2020, which I think we're still very, like, months and months away from, mm-hmm. They might be one of them.
Okay.
All right, Austin, so Khabib went on Instagram.
What was his last name?
Is that how you say it?
No, you're right. I just want to say his other name, too.
Oh, yeah, no.
Because I can't even say it.
Okay,
so you're good.
I was like, oh, no, did I totally mess this up? Nagamena
Shapirov. Yeah.
No, but he took to Instagram kind of saying, I understand everything, and I'm definitely upset that, you know, I'm canceling my fight. Probably like all others, I had plans after the fight, but I can't control it. So how does this impact UFC?
Dude, this is the biggest of all big deals, right? Because Tony Ferguson versus Khabib was going to be the biggest fight of the year, hands down. All right, they're two killers. I don't think Tony Ferguson has lost a fight, I want to say, in 8 or 12-something years. Khabib, obviously undefeated, you know, after his big win against Conor McGregor, obviously beat Dustin Poirier. So the thing about this fight, too, Kuz, is the fact that this is the fifth time this fight has been set up. First couple times was a weight cut issue. Another time was the fact Tony Ferguson, during fight week, during a press conference, tore his ACL over, like, a camcorder cable. So, like, this fight has been cursed since day one. Well, now, obviously, with COVID-19, I mean, it's almost the ultimate curse. So it is a big blow to the UFC. But now, supposedly, what Khabib said today, actually, a little update, was the fight was essentially off because Khabib couldn't get, like, a visa. He couldn't leave Russia because, obviously, everyone's on lockdown. But now I guess Russia's going to give him the okay to leave Russia and come to the United States for the fight. So keep your eyes peeled to that because, once again, and Dana White's been very adamant about this, they need this fight to happen because it's the biggest one of the year.
All right, so, Brent, your question would be... a group of presidents suggesting that they should go ahead and move the college season to the spring. Do you think that would be a good move?
Yeah, the college football season you talk about.
Yeah, sorry, football season.
Yeah, and I think it's interesting here because there is some thought that I've seen some people with more opinions on this in the last 48 hours or so that, listen, the college football season will happen one way or another. Why? Like we were talking about earlier, big business.
Cha-ching.
And they are not going to give up on that those dollars. Mm-hmm. So there are some that suggest even in January, if they had to push back to start the year, that it could happen. So I think anything's on the table there. I don't, again, I'll say what I've said in the past about these situations. Like Wimbledon just canceled too. I think those kind of places or events are canceling because the international draw from fans, but also players mm-hmm. that are going to have a hard time getting there and all the travel restrictions right now. I think places like college football, there's no rush to do that right yet. It's mm-hmm. fine to think about it. Contingency theories. But I do think they'll use the whole calendar of this year and even next year to start their season and play most of their season, if not all the season. I don't think that's very far-fetched.
All right, so my last question, ESPN put up a tweet. I believe it was yesterday, and then they had to change it for today because a lot of people were dragging them. They said, who is your favorite movie coach? And they left off the coach from Remember the Titans, and they left off Coach Carter. So I asked
Samuel
you guys.
Samuel Jackson.
We'll leave this up to both of you. Who's your go-to movie coach?
You can go first.
I'd have to think about it a little bit more, and you know me in movies, it's bad.
Right,
but the first one I would think of is Herb Brooks.
I was gonna,
in The Miracle.
Yeah. Who played him? Not Swayze.
Kurt Russell.
Thank you very much. Kurt Russell. Yeah, that one sticks out to me for sure.
It's probably not my top, but it's the one that jumps to my mind first.
Yeah. I'm trying to think, like, growing
keep
up, like, what's...
Keep in mind, they have Mr. Miyagi on this as well as a coach. Well,
that's a good one.
You know what? And this is crazy. This is a little story quick. So in my college career, my junior and senior year, me and the defensive tackle that played next to me, his name was Danny Blakemore. He's also a starter. We always listen to the Al Pacino speech from Any Given Sunday. Like, you know, where he talks about the inch or whatever.
Yeah.
And the inches add up. We listen to that speech before every single game my junior and senior year. So maybe I would say Al Pacino on Any Given Sunday.
Doug Kidd just texted me. He said Jim Morris from The Rookie.
Oh, there we go. That's a good one.
There's a lot of them.
John Candy from the bobsledding movie, Cool Runnings? Come on, man.
Yeah, very good.
The ones they have on their photo, they've got Patches O'Houlihan from Dodgeball.
I mean, take it seriously, though, huh? ESPN, what are we
doing?
They
got Jackie Moon from Semi-Pro.
Not taking it seriously, okay.
Yeah, just anybody they got Coach Klein from Waterboy.
Not even close to taking it seriously. And you're not going to put John Candy from Cool Runnings in. The guy took four Jamaican sprinters and put them on ice. And
they got Chubbs from Happy Gilmore.
It's all in the hips, Brent. It's all in the hips.
All right. How about if we end the show today with a new Yon tweet
in the last five minutes? Hit me with it. ESPN 690, I love you guys.
Was never about the money, Duval. My situation was handled piss poor.
Bad language
God
now.
God bless.
He's going full Jalen, baby. We have a heel turn. If you thought Roman Reigns or John Cena turning heel would be crazy, Yannick Ngakoue turning heel. That's the ultimate heel turn. I can't wait.
Multiple aggressive tweets daily now.
I love it.
It's happening.
I love it.
Will it work? I got a feeling we'll be talking more Yon tomorrow.
Bring it.
Come on, join the show, Yon. Let's go. Call us, 904-362-9901. We'd love to have you. Thanks for listening, everybody. Hope you all have a good night. Marshmallow baseball. Do it, but be careful and use the big marshmallows. I'll see you on TV tonight, CBS 47 and Fox 30.
First Take, Your Take with Jason Fitz.
I think what we have to remember here is that we all define MVP differently. What does MVP mean? Most valuable is a very gray area. Putting